They're savages. One lot steals a goat from another lot. Before you know it, they're ripping each other to pieces.
I never seen wildlings do a thing like this. I never seen a thing like this, not ever in my life.
How close did you get?
Close as any man would.
We should head back to the wall.
Do the dead frighten you?
Our orders were to track the wildlings. We tracked them. They won't trouble us no more.
You don't think he'll ask us how they died? Get back on your horse.
Whatever did it to them could do it to us. They even killed the children.
It's a good thing we're not children. You want to run away south, run away. Of course, they will behead you as a deserter if I don't catch you first. Get back on your horse. I won't say it again. Your dead men seem to have moved camp.
They were here.
See where they went. What is it?
Just a little over a decade ago, that opening scene played for an audience of over 2.2 million. Unknowingly to many, it was just the beginning of what would be an epic journey for HBO series cast and crew. They would break records and make television and arguably cinematic history. Good evening. I'm Gabe Ryan, and welcome to 10 Years to Here, the unauthorized Game of Thrones 10-year anniversary celebration. Tonight we'll be looking back on some of the moments that are our favorite throughout the series and overall how the show impacted society as a whole. A little bit later, I'll be joined by a good friend and somebody I consider to be a maester of the series, Vera Saeli. We'll be discussing how the show impacted society as a whole, but if you are itching for even more Game of Thrones content, you can test your trivia knowledge through quizzes and puzzles. You can check out the Digital Citadel, where you'll find everything you need to know about the wonderful world of Westeros. And you can also check out behind-the-scenes and making-of documentary featurettes to let you know exactly how they brought the story that we all love to life. You can get all of that at our website at makeiticonic.events/Game of Thrones. And now that I have finished my marketing obligations, we can get back into it. On that evening, many watched with blissful ignorance, but many were watching because they were fans of the George R. R. Martin series, A Song of Ice and Fire, the book series that the HBO series is based on, and they were ready. But over the course of the next 8 years and 8 seasons, many would realize just how ready they weren't. But whether you were watching the story for the first time, or you were watching the show for the first time, an intense time was had by all. Let's take a little stroll down memory lane to the couches where we watch history in the making.
Right.
What the hell?
Well, you've got to get into the thing of it, haven't you? You know, this is what they wear. You've got to get into the very, well, very genre.
You look a dickhead. You look ridiculous.
Let's get this show on the road. Roll VT.
Are there any rude bits in it?
Oh, I'm sure there are.
Do you reckon?
Yeah. Now,
who are these two then?
I think that's Jon Snow, and I don't know who she is. She looks...
She's very elegant, isn't she?
Looks like she's had a shock.
Now, look, do you know what Daenerys is thinking? I left this little motherfucker here 2 days, and he done messed up this that I didn't fix.
Where were you before? I could have used your help with Sansa.
With who? Sansa?
With Sansa, yeah. It was Christmas time, of course.
Look at this fool. You better beg. You got on mascara. Yeah, that's right. Hit your knees, son. Watch this. Oh! That's right, because I don't have a penis. I don't have a penis. And they disrespected me. Co-class!
So, how do I compare?
Oh, here he goes, making his move. Is he gone into the...
Every night.
She's been on the wine, the candlelit
romantic. Shush! Just listen.
And let me introduce you to my dragon. I wish I could blow fire. I wish I could blow fire. Oh my God, please give me a dragon. I want a dragon for my birthday.
Oh, look at that. Right in front of the dragons. It's like when the dog watches.
So you're the man.
Don't forget you a bastard too. You be forgetting just cause he gave you a name that you not a bastard. You're still a bastard. You killed your daddy. You're really a bastard. You're a bastard murderer. How about that?
Oh. There's Bran. You know his surname is Flakes, don't you?
Flakes.
Yeah. He needs to lighten up a bit, doesn't he?
Yes,
I mean, you know,
a bit.
He's a bit dour and... I mean, for goodness sake, go outside, build a snowman or something.
When they start playing that music, that's I'm just like, music. Damn, that's that dying music. That's that somebody about to die music. Look at him, all mud.
A muddy Jon Snow shows up at your apartment. You do not send him away.
I do not send him away, but he does not get into the bed. I got real nice sheets. He can't mess them up. But we can do it on the floor for sure.
If the horses last, we'll get there before the den. We just have to hope the Night King doesn't come first.
Oh my goodness.
What is it?
Oh, I don't know, but if he had blue eyes, he ain't got them now.
Please kill him.
Oh, my
beat his ass, Jon Snow!
Was Lyanna Stark.
Your father.
Big revelation there.
Your real father was Rhaegar Targaryen.
Oh,
you've never
been
a bastard.
That is a big revelation.
But it means nothing to us.
No.
So that was it then?
That was it.
What's all the fuss about?
Weird. I don't understand it.
I mean, riding around on a dragon.
Wanting elephants.
And of course, there's something about that relationship. Jon Snow and the blonde...
Yeah.
The blonde beauty.
Well, it's obviously something we... Yeah. We haven't got a clue about.
And four in a bed.
And ever slowly building as the show progressed was our love for the fantastic world of Westeros. Not just the characters and the story that was brought to life, but also our love for the actors that brought those characters to life. And as the impact that society felt from the show, based on the impact we all felt individually, began to spread, the actors began sharing more about their journey and how they came to be the characters that we know and love, which is exactly how we got little gems like this.
You play the Game of Thrones, you win or you die. Now, if you'll excuse me, I need to have sex with my brother.
Hi, thank you.
No, wait a minute. I have one more. Wait. You know nothing, Jon Snow.
Ow!
Sorry.
Take four.
Hoda!
Hi.
Take five.
Why, hello, Carl Drogo. Would you like to see my dragons?
And of course, there would be speculation as to what those characters would like if they were to join our life. Like, what would it be like if Melisandre were to go to a baby shower?
Welcome everyone to Alexian's baby shower. The first thing I want to do to kick things off is go around the room and everyone share an inspirational quote about motherhood. Sue, you want to start?
Okay, I really like this one. God could not be everywhere and therefore he created mothers.
Oh. Amber?
Your children will become what you are, so be what you want them to be.
Oh, that's really good. Melisandre?
Clutch your child close to your breast, woman, for the night is dark and full of terrors.
Okay, well, so do you guys know if it's gonna be a boy or a girl?
We're actually waiting until the big day.
Pray that it's a son, so that the Lord of Light can look down upon him with favor. And if it's a girl, lock it away in a dark tower forever and hope it's not consumed by grayscale.
You know, I think we'll be happy either way.
You should be. Boy or girl, a child is like heaven.
There is no heaven. There's only hell. And it's the one we're living in now.
Alexi, are you nervous for the big day?
Yeah, a little.
I think I'm more nervous than she is.
I tell you what, when I had Sean, I had them pump me full of every drug they could find.
I gave birth once.
Oh?
A shadow demon. I will never forget the way it emerged from my womanhood. Its claw-like hands grabbed onto my ankles so that it could propel itself into the night air. And then my little shadow assassin entered the camp of the false king Renly Baratheon and then stabbed him through the back.
Let's do presents.
Oh, it's a baby sheep.
Oh, it's so cute.
Yes, that's from me.
Yeah, we know.
It's Valyrian steel.
Why would you get us this?
Well, at night, your child will want to defend itself against anyone who will harm it, because the night is dark
and full of terrors.
Exactly. And also, it rattles. It's a rattle sword. Yes, rattle.
Just curious, how do you guys know one another?
We went to college together.
Oh, where'd you go?
Northwesteros.
Go, get it! Open mine.
Aww. 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 That was so cute.
Great job, Sid.
Oh, yeah.
That's from both of us.
Oh, no, no, it wasn't. It was from both of us.
Okay, so this next thing is fun. We did it at my shower, which was perfect. Let's all go around the room and say what we think Seth and Alexi's baby's gonna grow up to be.
Oh, I've got a good guess.
Me too.
I do not have to guess. I know what it will be. I have looked into the flames, and they have shown me your child's future profession.
No, we don't wanna know.
Dentist. What kind of cheese is this?
Oh, it's Gouda.
It's very Gouda.
I don't get it.
Oh my God.
Was it me?
Okay, maybe some characters should stay in that world, but the cartoon world is up for grabs, huh? And Game of Thrones made history when they were documented into industry canon, The Simpsons.
Anticipated series finales ever, and we promise spoiler-free zone. Millions of people around the world tuning in for the final episode, Game of Thrones, last night. Amy, you were one of them.
Yes. such a devoted following. I am among them. It has grown so much over the past 8 seasons. The highly anticipated series finale last night sending social media into a tailspin, leaving some fans and me shocked. Star Emilia Clarke revealing this morning even she didn't see this ending coming. Overnight, the only thing hotter than Dragon's Breath were the ratings. Millions of fans gathering around the globe with viewing parties galore, bidding farewell to the Iron Throne. If you were shocked by the ending, so are the number of people who won't be going to the office today. Around 27 million employees will miss work, arrive late, work remotely, or be less productive than usual. All thanks to the series finale. The series end also ends the showrunner's task of satisfying diehard fans with an epic finale, a task few have accomplished. While the series finale of MASH was well received in 1983,
I miss you. I'll miss you.
The final episode of HBO's other mega hit, Sopranos, and its fade to black, well, not so much. And not everyone was impressed with the game's finale either. The Detroit Free Press was meh. On Twitter, this fan wrote, worst episode of the entire series. Another fan saying, wow, I regret owning a television. And though the show may have come to an end, the impact of HBO's mega hit lives on.
The last season reportedly bringing in over 30 million viewers per episode in the U.S. alone. The HBO hit going down in history with 132 Emmy Award nominations and winning 47 of them. As to whether you were outraged or overjoyed, some truly suffered after the HBO app crashed on some unlucky fans. As for the Iron Throne's bittersweet ending, I think Grey Worm and Gendry said it best.
I think it's not what you think it's going to be.
Yeah, it's surprising. Don't underestimate Game of Thrones' capacity to still surprise you and pull the rug from underneath you.
Now, regardless of whether or not you watched the show from the very beginning or you didn't watch the show at all, you are probably more than aware that the final season had built a bit of tension between fans and showrunners. One of the reasons that is most noted for that is because it felt like we were meeting a whole new character in the character of Daenerys in season 8 as opposed to Daenerys in seasons 1 through 7. Throughout her story arc, we had watched her go from a timid girl who had been enslaved and, you know, outcast from her family, and grow into this badass chick who is fighting for equality and just, yeah. And then we met Dany in season 8, which it was kind of like, well, no, it was kind of like this.
Gosh, what an honor. What an honor this is.
Thank you so much.
Now, what? Remind me again, what is your real name?
Karen.
Tell me a little bit about yourself. I mean, where are you originally from?
The forest. With all my dragons. That's me. My dragons helped me build it.
And does he have a name?
This one?
No, or anyone.
Oh. Carl.
Karen.
Carlicia.
Carly Carlicia. What are your hobbies?
I play the mandolin.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
And what do you do for fun besides dancing and playing the mandolin?
I do spells on people.
That's like a witch type of thing?
No.
I don't know, sure.
When you go out on the bridge and your dragon's coming too, and you're looking for a friend and you say, "Hey, Carl, where are you?" Rocks are coming down the path to the castle and everybody says, "Come on, guys.
Come on, guys.
What's the hassle? Why not feel wonderful?
Oh, that's it. Yeah, wonderful. Why not feel wonderful? Oh, my gosh. Thanks to Khaleesi, Mother of Dragons.
Okay, maybe it wasn't that bad. I mean, there was a lot more death, so, you know. But even if you weren't fans of the books, it became more noticeable towards the end that they were lacking a little bit of foundational substance. The book series, A Song of Ice and Fire, ends where Jon Snow dies, which in the Game of Thrones series happens at the end of season 5, which means there are basically 3 seasons that were written without any source material. And this makes some book fans understandably worried because they're worried about whether or not the books are going to end like the show did. When Martin was asked about this, he gave us a very George R. R. Martin response. He said, "Well, yes, and no, and yes, and no, and yes, and no, and yes." The cryptic answer is a bit of a George R. R. Martin calling card, but it has reignited everyone's excitement for the final installment, Winds of Winter, or we thought final installment, Winds of Winter. He then announced that there would be an additional installment entitled A Dream of Spring. So, will we know the end of the story anytime soon? No. No, we won't. But tonight is not about the future, it is about the past. And with clarity akin to that of the Three-Eyed Raven, we will be revisiting the series and the journey that we have all come to know and love. But first, it would be remiss, with Memorial Day being this weekend, if we didn't first take a moment to pause and remember those we lost along the way.
I saw what I saw. I saw the White Walkers.
I've been sitting here for days! Start the damn joust before I piss myself!
You are not holding a battle axe, you are holding...
a needle. Ah.
Just so.
La Nathirian. Hush is ici.
You think my life is some precious thing to me, as I would trade my honor for a few more years of work. I learned how to die a long time ago.
It got to the point where I would say his name every night before I went to bed. Willem. 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 I buried an axe so deep into Willem's skull I had to bury him with it.
Forever.
I pulled you into the world. Both of you. I've seen both your faces almost every day since, and for that I consider myself very, very lucky.
Dead men, and worse, come hunting for us in the night. Do you think it matters who sits on the Iron Throne?
For I'm a lady, Westerosi customs are still a bit foreign to me.
It's hard to keep all the rules straight. If I remember my lessons, a woman of noble birth is always called a lady.
We have to get the guards back, and then we will kill them all.
Tell your father I'm here. And tell him the Lannisters aren't the only ones who pay their debts.
You know nothing, Jon Snow.
I am the shield! The guards are out for men! I wait for my life! And all that in the night's watch! Release them!
Stand, boy.
We don't kneel for anyone beyond the wall.
I'm afraid. I've always been afraid.
Ah!
read about Valerian the Dread. They say you can still see his skull in the dungeons beneath the Red Keep.
Go on, do your duty.
I'd hate to die like your son, clawing at my neck, foam and bile spilling from my mouth, eyes blood red, skin purple. It was horrible enough for me, a shocking scene. Not at all what I intended.
I'd like to see the beaches again.
My people are not peaceful. We will protect you.
I hope I deserve this. Truly, I do. I hope I'm wrong.
I'm the man who killed Jaime Lannister.
like we.
This week, I had the pleasure of sitting down with my good friend Vera Saeli, who is kind of like a maester of the show, if there were to be one. She's not only the person that introduced me to Game of Thrones, which I then binge-watched in the interim time between season 7 and 8, but she's also the person that I would consult about any confusing plot points along the way, and if you are familiar with the story, I'm sure you are familiar with that feeling. And so we got together this past week to have a little conversation about some of our favorite points in the writing, its impact on society as a whole, and maybe commiserate just a little bit. Obviously, you're the person to have on because of your knowledge, and I refer to you in a description I wrote as the maester of the show. Because you're like who I would go to in all of those times when everything was confusing, which I feel like, I don't know, maybe I'm alone in this, and maybe this is something you share, and what kind of led to your knowledge is the confusion is kind of part of the enjoyment.
Well, it is, and you know, and I love the way it's written, because it's not like they could just pick up the phone and call you. You know, they had to send ravens, they had meisters who were not always truthful in their history tellings, so nobody really had hard truths to go by for what they were facing in the time period that we're involved in Game of Thrones.
Yeah, and something I just realized, it's crazy because, you know, as you rewatch things, you pick up more and more. Even after you, like, you know everything, there's, like, you catch something. I thought it was funny in one of the final episodes, Sir Davos corrects somebody's grammar. And it's so funny because just like a season ago, he didn't even know how to read.
Exactly. Right.
Like that, even that adds on to the whole conundrum of the time period it's set in that, like, even if you could get a raven to somebody, which, like, low chances of that depend on how you were born, the chances of them being able to read it are like slim to none.
And I think as you had seen in the show, the ravens were only going back and forth between places that had meisters, lords, you know, at the wall, you know,
right.
The Lord Commander is educated. So, you know, poor people, they just had oral histories to go by. And I think that we'd seen the meisters weren't the most reliable of those tellers of history.
Yeah. You know, I think there are so many analogies you can make for the title, A Song of Ice and Fire. Mm-hmm. I always think of the Robert Frost poem. It's like my favorite poem ever. And just talking about how destruction of either kind, of either like complete aggression or complete neglect, right, are equally as harmful and destructive. But a small part of that analogy I see in, you know, Sam wanting to become a maester and, I feel like this part of the cunningness of the maesters is that they are stuck living a life with little excitement, that they'd rather have excitement. It's like when you have a job that you don't want, you're not really doing the job to the best, like you're doing other things. And Sam is like the kind of guy that you want telling the history, that actually cares about the information.
That cares about the truth.
Right. And I as we're going to be talking about like the cultural impact of the show, I think one of the big differences in the time periods between today's society, and then is just that there's not this assumed or obligatory road that you have to walk down to live your life, period. Right. You know, you're not expected to do, you know, I mean, we have the expectation of, you know, you go to school, you graduate, you go to college, or, you know, go to the workforce or whatever. But I mean, these people, like, just the women's rights, like, in stark comparison.
Good one.
But there are just so many different assumed things about the way people had to live. I mean, like, just take Sam's story, how he got to the Night's Watch. I mean, his dad telling him, you know, you're either going to do it this way or I'm going to disown, you know.
Right. I'm going to take you out and there's going to be an unfortunate accident.
Right.
Right. Right. And he, like, was ashamed of his son.
Yeah. And I mean, that's something we can all, a lot of people can relate to. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, there's not as much of that now because of a lot of the changes, thank God. But to get to the show, the other shows that were coming out around the time, very much of anti-hero type genre. And despite there being a saturation of that in what people were watching back in 2000, what was it?
2011.
Yeah, 2011. There's still quite a bit of difference. What ways do you think those differences kind of helped the longevity and the staying power of the show?
Honestly, I think it was the story. It's a tale that's classic, but done in a completely different way. You know, a lot of the people who were so excited about Game of Thrones in the first place were people who read the books. And those people who didn't read the books, they started to be like, okay, what's this show about? Well, you have a classic tale of, you know, treachery, you know, family, honor, loyalty, you know, bastards, dwarves, whatever they're called, little people. I don't know what you're supposed to call them these days. Had all these elements that, you know, like, people who didn't read the story were just like, what's this? You had politics, you know, I mean, in the first episode, you had an opening scene of these undead things, you know, it's like, so right there, that's going to capture people's attention, because keep in mind, at that time too, The Walking Dead was hugely popular, okay? It was like taking off on a cultural phenomenon itself. So then people had this medieval show that had undead creatures in it. Like, what's this? What is this show?
Yeah. You know, on it speaks to, I think the writing is definitely something that kept people, but yes. I think the attraction is really a testimony to the production value, because you're right, it's not a story that hasn't been told before.
Correct.
Even though it has been told before, who was I talking to? My friend Katie. We were talking about the one thing about Game of Thrones that really, or that she really enjoyed, was that none of the costumes were clean. Because one of the, like, trademark visuals for medieval type shows and movies is that there'll, you know, the set will be great, and then, like, they will just look way too bathed and clean to be, like, part of the world. So there's this disconnect that, however minor, I feel like the most minor can be the most annoying at times.
But, you know, and they did. I mean, in that first season, well, they didn't have the production quality that they ended up having. But you're right, in that first season, you know, the kids look a little bit dirty. You know, they're in mud, and look, you can hear them going through the muck, you know. So, you know, the guy that from the Night's Watch who, like, came down from the north was filthy and disgusting, as he should have been. You know, even when John goes off to the wall, they've been on the road for days. Instead of hair looking beautiful and face completely clean, they were dirty. you know? Right. So yeah, they did add that element to it, which was very much appreciated, I think, by a lot of fans.
I know you read up on the writing aspect of things, but do you watch any of the behind the scenes stuff as far as production and whatnot? Or
I watched the special that they did at the end of the last season, behind the scenes, how they made the snow, and it was actually really fun to watch that and see all the work that went into that show. It was just absolutely phenomenal.
Right. I can't remember if it's in that one or if it's in something else. If I have a clip, I'll insert it here. But there was the writers, D&D, were talking about pitching the show. Mm-hmm. And they said it was kind of like a covert operation of, we know this isn't really what's on right now, and it's a really, really big risk. But, it's mostly just dialogue with a couple short battle sequences or something in between, knowing full well the scale that if it were to take off, it would be.
Battle sequences, right, and dragons.
Right. because it's funny, too, because, a lot of fans will say the first season was a little bit of a drag.
Right.
Just because there was a lot to establish. There's a lot
there
of
establishing stuff. You had to set up these two big threats, right? The threat of who's on the throne, and then the threat of the White Walkers. Okay. And all of that had to come together in that one season. You had to set up the dynamic of the Stark family, right? And the Lannisters, and I can understand the first season. No, it wasn't like some of the other seasons, but that was to getting to know who these people are and setting the story for what was to come and what the catalyst was for what happened next. So, I love the first season. I mean, you go back and rewatch it, you can definitely tell they didn't have the budget that they had later on, but
right.
I love the story. Again, the story was just so good.
Well, even the story was it's very good. It just was very slow moving, and it wasn't even necessarily the story itself that made it that way. It was just when they would do establishing shots of just locations, before you get to the dialogue and stuff. Those were a little bit longer, I feel like, and drawn out. So it seemed like, there's not much going on, which is weird that it caught on with such hooks.
And I have to say, although they did make, changes, I have to say they did the first season so close to the first book, which was a humongous success. And they really, except for certain changes, they did follow that story in the first season. And even in the books, I know what you're talking about, how they zone in on Winterfell and they show you, the castle and Winterfell going across. That's how you were introduced to things in the novels as well. And it was the success of that first book that launched all of this. So, and they pretty much kind of stuck to it. They did make some changes, from the novels. Because how do you do a novel and even in a whole season of shows, how do you do that? But they stayed very close to that first book for the first season. So while it might've been a little bit slow in comparison with the other seasons, it opened up that story. And then I thought that was brilliant because that first book was a catalyst for everything that followed after.
I haven't read the books, but from what you're saying there, it sounds like his writing is very descriptive.
It is. To the food, to the wine. I mean, I wanted to drink mulled wine because of this book. I didn't even know what mulled wine was. It made ale sound appealing and the food sound appealing. It's very descriptive, very much so.
Which I feel like might be part of the reason that the book caught on so much, because I feel like there's two types of readers.
Mm-hmm.
Ones that like to read, they like to use their imagination. So they need very little.
Mm-hmm.
Most people like everything to be handed to them. That's why we like TV more than reading. We just like it to be handed to us. So I feel like the more descriptive, the less they have to work at imagining the world around them.
The best way I could describe his novels is he literally recreates a world that if you almost forget it isn't real. Is, I guess, the best way to describe
They said that one of the big things that they had to focus on and keep at the forefront when they started working on adapting was that one of the pitfalls of the fantasy genre in general was that they focus on the dragons and magic more than the character and the story.
Right. Which I was always a little bit disappointed with Game of the Show that they left out so much of that because, and most book readers are, because a lot of that magic that they left out was really integral to the story of those characters, some of those characters anyway. And it felt very absent without, and some things kind of didn't make even some sense without some of that stuff being brought into it later on as we get into other seasons. But, you know, it is what it is. It was an amazing show, and I get it. They didn't want to make it like a straight on fantasy show, but it's what it is. I mean, bottom line, it's what it is.
Right. You make that point. At the same time, one of like the big draws of it is that it's very like super realistic. So as much as like it doesn't necessarily follow the storyline of the book to a T, do you think that maybe some of it was removed to make it easier to understand? Or
I think, and based off of what they've said in interviews, they didn't want it to be like a strictly like fantasy show. Well, the novels aren't strictly fantasy either. I mean, you really do have this political, you know, espionage going on for the Game of Thrones in the novels. So, yes, there's this whole other element of, you know, magic, but all of it's connected, and you know, and it's all connected anyway. Either so that's when there are certain things I wish they would have brought into it, and there's certain things that I understand why they didn't. And then also time is a factor. You know, they don't get to have 20 episodes a season, so I understand why they have to cut some things.
You know, in an interview J.K. Rowling did, she said, you know, they didn't always follow the books to a T because of that. And even though there is an audience for a six-hour Harry Potter movie,
that's not
what they were looking to make.
Right.
So in that creation or in their execution of the show, they kind of coined a phrase that was new at the time called sextaposition, which is basically just sexually presenting people in the background that are not related to or going on with like the main plot or the subjects of that scene, to the point that it became like very common to hear people say that it was just a show about dragons and tits. Now we live in an era that's like, I don't want to say post Me Too, but post like the impact of Me Too. You know what I mean? Like the initial impact of the Me Too movement. And we live in this cancel culture that looks back and, you know, a lot of the things that we were tolerant of in media in the past or we're not so tolerant now. And that's not something that Game of Thrones falls prey to.
No.
What do you think kind of shields it from that?
I honestly think it was the massive fan base that Game of Thrones had, because during some of the seasons, there was a lot of backlash towards some of the things that were shown on Game of Thrones. Ironically, nobody cared that, you know, Cersei was having sex with her brother, but they cared about the fact that, you know, when her son died, when Joffrey died and he took her, you know, he like had sex with her, you know, when she didn't want to, that's what they latched onto. It's like, you know, she's been banging her brother for years and has her brother's kids, but that's okay, right? So and what happened with Sansa, you know, when she was married to what's his name? Oh my gosh. Oh my gosh, what was wrong? Ramsay Bolton. No, when they didn't even show the rape scene and people like lost their collective heads about it. So Game of Thrones had that backlash.
Well, I knew that they had toned stuff down. I didn't know that it was necessarily because of backlash, because like
they did have a lot of backlash.
Like I know that the scene where the lady from the Sept is torturing Cersei.
Oh, when Cersei, and then she tortures her back.
Yeah. The mountain was originally supposed to rape her, not just torture her.
And they didn't put it on camera because we were coming into this time of like, oh, you know what, this is just too heavy. You know, people are going to lose their collective minds again, you know, because it did happen before in earlier seasons where, you know, there was petitions and all this and that about some of the scenes in Game of Thrones. And, you know, the sex was too frequent, the nudity was too frequent, you know, the violence and all of that just fueled the fan to, you know, we're just hungry for more of the story. You know, they could have cared less from the people, you know, the pearl clutchers. You know, if you're clutching your pearls that much, then you might not want to watch a show like that. It's, you know, it's just
clutch your remote, don't watch it. Change the channel.
Yeah. Don't watch it then. That's not the show for you. You know, it's really simple. Turn it off.
It's find not something like they're putting porn on.
Right. You know, find a show that's, I don't know, like Dr. Quinn Medicine Woman or something, because clearly you can't handle, you know, a show like Game of Thrones.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. I feel like the underlying theme of this whole conversation is just going to be about the fact that, like, the realism and the fact that it's a show about people at its essence. Like you said, like, it's not really a fantasy show. I never considered it that. I mean, even when it was going on, I did prior to watching it. After I like started watching it, I realized you could take out the dragons and replace it with any large weapon.
Right.
And replace the magic with technology and have the same story.
You know what I mean? Very much so. You know, you're going to have, you know, your players, you're going to have your people who sacrifice everything, you know, like Jon Snow. You're going to have your power hungry people, you know, like, and don't get it twisted, people. I love Daenerys, but let's face it, she was all about power, you know. So you're right. Give her a weapon, those dragons could have easily been, you know, bomber planes or something. I don't know. Right. You know, so, but you're right. It's still about humanity at its core and who we are when times are difficult. So that's, I think, the appealing thing. Like I said, it's an old story, but it's just done in a different way.
Right. And I think one of the things that made it such an impacting show to so many is because of the fact that it had so many different kinds of characters, and they juggled telling the stories so well that you never felt like you were missing any of them for long until eventually they would die, always too soon in the eyes of the viewer. You know, it's interesting making the comparison and talking about cultural impact, just in, you know, you're talking about the Maesters changing the history. And people making an uproar to get things taken out of Game of Thrones. Not that it's a historically accurate show, like it's not a history telling.
No.
But I think there is a danger to covering up our past just because it's ugly.
Right.
You know, they say those who don't know history are doomed to repeat it.
Exactly.
And I think of like the removal of Confederate statues and things of that nature, where we just want to kind of brush it under the rug, which, like, I'm for the removal of like, I don't think we should make monuments to bad things, but like, okay, like changing the education on slavery and changing, you know, like the education on the Holocaust and stuff. Like, what are we doing? You know, you're just writing a blank page for the next crazy person. But I digress. Getting back to the point. Okay, so the scale of the show didn't necessarily have to be that big. I mean, thank God it was. And I think we're all very thankful that it was. But there were medieval shows in the past, and there were even, you know, we talked about cutting scenes of extreme brutality and whatnot, but there are ways that you can make it work and cut around things to make a lot less seem like a lot more. I mean, that's kind of part of the magic of Hollywood. Right. Why do you think the spending in Game of Thrones production is more justifiable than a lot of the flashbang we see in Hollywood today?
I would say Game of Thrones, over the years that it was the humongous hit that it was still part of entertainment that you had to wait week to week to see. Okay. You're not going to be able to binge it all at once. You know, if you're watching this show real time, you still had to wait week to week to see. The story is so grand as things progress. I don't think that there's any other choice that they wouldn't spend that kind of money, you know, on a show like that. They were basically giving you movie quality shows once a week. And that became what people are going to expect. You know, if you're making this amazing show and it's awesome every week, I want the same thing over and over. I want the same thing. So, of course, the budget was going to be grand and grander and the grandest, because the show just kept getting bigger, bigger, gaining more popularity. Yes, each year went on. You know, it exploded Comic-Con, you know, when that came around. I mean, there was really not a show like it on TV, you know. So, of course, they were going to spend big money. And I don't think that they could have not spent big money for the story the way it was progressing, that you had to do better. You had to keep doing better because fans demand it.
Oh, right. Well, I mean, like, they even knew going into it, you know, like I said, there was kind of a pulling the wool over the studio's eyes a little bit in the pitch as to where they were going in terms of budget.
Right.
And I think that that is communicated through the story by the story being so well done, like the story itself. I think part of what makes flashbang or, you know, like attractional technology or whatever tacky is when it's just there without purpose.
Right. Which is, that was actually with all the criticisms of the last season. There was amazing production, right, in the last season. I mean, fantastic. But a lot of people were not happy with it because it seemed to lose that substance, like what you were talking about. It was less about the characters and more about spectacle, you know, and I think that was a huge criticism of the final season that people had.
I can see that, but then, like, I don't know, on some level, I've become so numb when people bitch about the last episode or just the last season or whatever, because I'm like,
I do too.
When did we become so fucking entitled to the point where we think that we need, like, if you think that's how it should end, then go fucking write that ending. You know what I mean? Like,
I need to have
disappointed in things, but like, right. On some level, it's like, it's never going to be perfect.
No, it won't be perfect. And nobody needs to redo an entire season because you didn't like the way it was done. That's just not how the world works.
Right.
You know, so yeah, I understand some of the criticisms. I've had a few criticisms of it, but overall, I just was blown away by the work that went into that last season. You know, it was just amazing.
Well,
so
I think they kind of had to put that documentary out because of the bitching over the, like, bye season. Like, the year that we had nothing.
We didn't have anything, right?
They're like,
right.
Here, see, we really were doing something.
Yeah, we were working hard for you.
Right. And they said, you know, one of the things that made Game of Thrones, like, the book series popular or a good adaptation is that part of the reason a lot of fantasies fall flat is that they don't have enough lore to make it realistic.
Right.
Like you were saying when you were describing how he writes, you literally have to build this world.
He does. Part of when I was reading Fire and Blood, which is the history of the Targaryens, which we'll see some of that in a prequel that they're doing for HBO. I literally almost forgot what I was reading wasn't real. It was written so much like a real history text, but more interesting, of course. But you had to take a step back and be like, this is fiction. And he does this amazing job of bringing so much realism to his characters and the world around these characters that, you know, you forget this isn't real. You know, there's languages, you know, that people speak, you know, they're made up languages, you know, the actors think of the show, they had to learn these made up languages and speak them. And, you know, none of that's real. It's all just a story. It's just a story.
I love quotes and words and stuff. That was the thing I found fascinating, was that they got somebody to create the language of Dothraki and,
yes,
teach it to people. And they were saying he would critique people's Dothraki, whatever. And they said it was particularly funny because he would literally be the only person who would know.
Right. Because he made it up.
Right.
And Old Valyrian is not a language, but on the show, you forget that it isn't. You know, right. It's like Valamaharlis or whatever. You start speaking like them and you don't even know that, you forget this isn't even a real language.
Right. Yeah. Now, I've been watching a little bit of Harry Potter stuff, mm-hmm, because this is the 20th year anniversary of that. Mm-hmm. So I've been seeing some ties and stuff in that, but just with the production, J.K. Rowling was talking about walking onto the set of the Gryffindor common room and being able to pick up comic books that were written in this wizarding world, and just all mm-hmm the things that you would never see as a viewer,
right,
but just make the world so tangible,
make it so real,
right,
even in production, to your actors and to the directors and the staff, make it as real as possible, then you'll get a really good sense of it is real. It's easier for them to act. That's why so many actors don't like doing the green screen, because it's so not real.
Right. And as you know, thankfully, it was pitched to HBO.
That's who I always wanted it to go to when I was reading those books. I was like, it's got to be on HBO.
Well, I mean, to what you were just saying, I don't think any other company or very few companies would have put the money into locational shooting
that they
did to blend the CGI with practical shots.
Right. No, I don't think that any other company, honestly, would have taken a chance on something like that. It was, like you said before, this was not a show that we're used to seeing. You know, how many shows like this were on TV? None. None. So yes, you would see movies with themes like that were going on in Game of Thrones, but you didn't see TV shows like that. So, I think I told you on the last podcast when we were talking, when I was reading the book for the first time, I told my husband, I was like, this has to be on HBO. This is too much for a movie, right? You can't do a movie and do this justice. No way. I even had Sean Bean cast as Ned Stark. I'm like, he'd be perfect, And so he laughed and laughed at me. And then when they announced that they were going to bring this to HBO, I just totally lost my shit. HBO. Yes, there were other, there's Showtime, there was Cinemax at that time. It had to be HBO because they had groundbreaking shows, right? They're notorious for groundbreaking shows. So I couldn't see it on any other network but HBO.
But, talking about cultural impact and what you were just saying, mm-hmm, I feel like Game of Thrones is a big part of why we're moving, I don't want to say away from movies,
I am.
But we're kind of like, we're kind of moving to in between TV shows and movies.
Mm-hmm. I've like, been saying that for a long
limited series where
right.
it's too long for a TV show, but it's, or, but it's,
well, it's too long for a movie,
but it's too right. short for a TV show. And
I love this.
It just puts out better storytelling, I think.
It does. It really does. I've been saying for a long time, and I know like people around me are tired of hearing me say it. Movies don't have that it factor to me anymore. You can see content on the HBOs, you know, Netflix, you know, Hulu, that blows movies out of the water. You know, the story, that they have the big production budgets, you know, they're not these chintzy little production budgets. And it really does seem like that's where things are kind of headed. You know, you see all big actors moving into that kind of format and doing things for like Netflix and HBO, and some of the content is just fantastic. And I do believe Game of Thrones was one of the catalysts to do that. Look what we did. Look, like these people could say, look what we did. We brought an epic show to this network that worldwide had more fans than almost any other show in history, right? And it was a TV show. Movies, they don't have that impact always. You know, the fan base of Game of Thrones is unbelievable. You know, and even the ones that are mad about the last season, they're such a tiny fraction of that fan base.
Well, there's always, you know, it's the thing about the internet is generally like the loudest group is the smallest group.
Yes, because they make the drama.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, we were talking about how it was kind of the last of the water cooler shows, or the yes. shows you had to wait for to come out and you'd talk right. about, you know. I think that is, I think it's going to be more difficult for a lot of new projects in the future to get that connection with fans going to this streaming world of just like season dumping, you know, where they'll yes. like dump a season, because the longevity of which you're watching the whole story helps kind of solidify that connection. I mean, the whole thing about this being the 10-year anniversary of Game of Thrones is that like we've literally almost been on this journey for 10 years.
I have been longer.
I mean, like yeah. the people that have been watching from the beginning, you know, like
yes.
it's not just a weekend that you binged it and then it's exactly. over.
Exactly. And those of us who read the book, we've been on the journey way longer than when those of us who are, and we're still waiting by the books, by the way, so the rest of them. Oh. But yes, that was a decade of our lives that we were immersed in this cultural phenomenon, you know, like. I remember I had to block time when Game of Thrones came out. At the time, on Sundays, that was usually the only night of the week I actually got to watch TV because of my schedule. And, you know, the kids, you know, they wanted to watch, you know, The Walking Dead. So I would record Game of Thrones because it was on a whole other level, you know, than The Walking Dead. So that would be my little pleasure. You know, I'd be sitting up after they went upstairs and went to bed watching Game of Thrones, you know, on Sundays. So yeah, you're right. It's well, definitely
a brief stint. I lived with you. You would watch yeah. Game of Thrones, and then you would watch Game of Thrones. Like yes. you would watch it immediately after, or the again. Next day.
Yes, again, I did do that because there's so many things you can miss in an episode. You know, words were not for anything. You know, certain things were said; they had purpose. So I didn't want to like miss that with distractions in my household.
Right. I feel like it's the excitement.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of like, you know, like in movies and TV when they they'll like go into like a dream sequence and everything gets kind of like hazy.
Yes.
Like that's what it kind of is.
The first go round, it's like, oh, you
know, right, like, yeah, it's just like everything is just, I'm just so excited, like I'm just happy to be here. Like
exactly. You know, I'm like when that HBO logo would come up and it's like, oh yes, you know, here we go.
Right, and then after you change your pants, you can enjoy the episode.
And you're right, you don't get that with streaming and binging. You don't get that feeling, you know, right. But the feeling is gone. So in HBO, I gotta give them credit, they're still sticking to their guns and doing shows 1 week, you know, It's going to drop a show each week. They're still sticking to that format. Right. So.
Well, I mean, like, there's anticipation in streaming. It just dies after the first episode.
Yeah, because you know you can sit and watch three seasons of something.
Right. Well, I mean, like, even if they're doing season by season, like, you might be waiting for the new season, but then after it comes out, like, until the next season, you're not waiting for anything.
No, you're not. So unless you really love it. There are some shows I did binge watch, you know, of course, that I absolutely love, you know, big time. So, you know, I am waiting for them to come back. You know, I'm
kind of like one of those things. Have you ever, as an adult, wished you had like a parent to like keep you in line sometimes?
No. I don't like authority figures. I like to just be my own boss. See,
the streaming option is something I do take advantage of, but it's something that I would like to be like kept from me. You know, like,
you need some parental controls.
Yeah, like you don't need to just sit here and stream 8 seasons of this show today.
Well, and I just had a conversation with my best friend about this. You know, it's a holiday weekend. Oh. The weather's really gross, right? It's going to rain, okay? And she's like, what are you doing this weekend? And I said, well, I'm going to celebrate my son's birthday. And then on Sunday, I'm going to stream something. I'm going to binge something. That's the thing, you know? And I know what show I'm going to binge. I'm trying to watch it now, but, you know, I work a lot, so I can't just binge, you know? The Last Kingdom on Netflix. And if you ever find The Last Kingdom, enjoy it. Sort of, yes. You know, I'm also a PhD in that show as well.
Did you tell me about that show before?
I did.
Okay. I was going to say, yeah, that sounds so familiar.
It's a great show. And I will say this. Netflix and everybody else, like in media and entertainment, are always looking for that next Game of Thrones. That's what Game of Thrones has been. Everybody's looking to see, will this be the next Game of Thrones? And so far, nothing has been. And I don't know that you can recreate that again. But, you know, there's shows that have come out, like The Witcher, you know, The Last Kingdom, Shadow and Bone on Netflix. You know, critics and media writers, they keep saying, will this be the next Game of Thrones? Probably not. You know, you don't usually get multiple phenomenons like that.
Like, the thing about The Standard is that it sets the standard. You know what I mean?
Yes.
You're never going to have an exact replica.
No.
Because everything is trying too hard, almost.
To meet that, you know, that standard. And you know, you got to have, like I said, everything has to start with a good story. So if that's missing, you're already setting yourself up to fail, but you have to start with that good story. And now, you know, there's these shows, like, I know there was like Vikings that, you know, on the History Channel, where people are like, oh, maybe this will be the next Game of Thrones. No, yeah, you know, I don't think we're going to see that for probably a very, very long time, if at all.
I think we'll see a show to that scale and magnitude, but not in the same genre.
I think when HBO is bringing a show that has full support, House of the Dragon, it's a prequel and takes a chunk out of the histories of the Targaryens. But it's not going to be like Game of Thrones, I don't feel. Part of that reason is because of the backlash of the last season of Game of Thrones. And I don't know if they're going to have characters that people can latch onto like they did in Game of Thrones. I mean, let's be real. You know, having that family, that Stark family, people could relate to. You know, you had Ned Stark, you know, Honor, father, you know, you had that dysfunction within the family, the way the, you know, his wife couldn't stand his bastard child. You got to know these characters and feel for these characters. And then, of course, you chop off the head of the main one. So I don't know that you're going to see that kind of character connection again, you know, even when they do this prequel. I don't know if they can pull that off.
Yeah, I'm not sure either, because almost in the way that just like history doesn't seem relatable. I mean, it's like when you watch something about like World War II, you know it happened, you know it's all legit, but it doesn't feel relatable because it's so different from
your life.
Right.
And right.
And totally I feel like it'll be hard to connect with the prequel because it'll be viewed as a prequel, like the like a history of how we got to the story we love.
Correct.
You know,
correct.
It's almost like the anticipation of seeing or connecting the characters from that show to this new one will override our ability to connect to new characters.
That's what I'm thinking, and everything I've read about it so far. This happened so long ago, right?
You know, yeah, how many years? Like 1,000 years?
No, maybe like a few hundred. I mean, you heard references to it throughout the show. You know, the little girl, Stannis's daughter, who taught Davos to read, you know, she was reading the stories about the Dance of Dragons. So to Davos, and that's what she was using to teach him to read. And she just loved the story. Well, we're going to go see that part, you know, in the prequel. What happened with the Targaryens that led to this battle in this war with their dragons? That's what they're going to do the prequel on. So none of our characters that we have fallen in love with over the last 10 years will be featured in that prequel. So I think that kind of sets it up right there to not be as nearly as epic as Game of Thrones was. You know, people loved Ned Stark. People loved Tyrion Lannister. You know, they loved Jon Snow. They loved Daenerys. And so we're not going to have anybody like that to kind of attach to again.
Right. Shifting gears a little bit from like the impact to the writing itself. In the last season, you know, one of the big critiques is that Daenerys's story arc kind of plummeted too quick for realistic expectation. I don't know, whatever. But corruption is almost like that.
It is.
You know, I mean, it is a very, it's like a dam breaking. You know, there's a lot behind it that you didn't see until you see it all at once, you know? And as I was preparing, you know, to talk about this and stuff, I was watching something that was talking about the actor that played Varys was super upset with how it ended, just his but revisiting that particular part of the story, do you think like the fact that she had to kill Varys at all like played a part in how quick she snapped toward everybody, like just a feeling of not being able to trust anybody? And because like everybody that she surrounded herself with came from there.
Right. I am not on the same page as people who feel that she snaps so quickly.
Me either.
I love her character because her character is complex. She is capable of great love and kindness, and she's capable of great brutality. So and she always has been, you know, except before she married Khal Drogo. Okay. We didn't see that, you know, part of her. She was a scared young girl before she married Khal Drogo. And living the life as a Khaleesi, she learned very quickly what brutality was. And she came to embrace it. In the very first season, I don't know how anybody could think that she isn't capable of brutality the way she was so vindicated and felt so good about the fact that her husband murdered her brother. Yes, her brother was a dick. But, you know, that smug look on her face when it happened, you know, you can't forget that because that's the start that we're seeing. She's capable of brutality and embraces some brutality.
Right.
So I don't get where people think she was this perfect little angel who just suddenly lost her shit.
Well, you know? I mean, there's also, you know, when you look at people that are in abusive relationships, even they have a connection that if they saw their abuser killed in front of them would not have a smug look on their face.
Right. And she was just like, You know, like,
right. And like up until that point, you're right. Like, we didn't see like a whole lot from her other than like timid, you know, low
girl
key.
Who cried because she was sold as a slave basically to this big behemoth, very fine man. But right. Anyway, mm-hmm. Right. That could be a whole other podcast. But anyway,
rip my throat out.
Yeah. Right. But seriously, like when she got sold into, you know, the Dothraki, you started to see her change. Okay. Yes, she didn't like slavery because she herself was sold basically as a slave. But you started to see in that very first season what she's kind of made of, you know. She burned the woman alive, okay, that tried to help her. She tricked her, you know, to help her husband, Khal Drogo. She burned her alive. Does that not tell you, like, what we're dealing with as a person? You know, and that's why I can't understand, like, the people who are crying the most about her, are they the people who binge-watched Game of Thrones, maybe, and hasn't been with this story for the last decade, maybe? I don't know. Because those who have read about her, those who've been watching her, we see what she's capable of if she's pushed too far, you know? So it was no shock.
It almost reminds me of, like, if a vigilante was just let to do.
Yes, because she did hurt people who were bad.
Right. Right. I mean, like, we get this, like, thing that, like, if you take out the bad guy, that you're the good guy. But,
right.
But
not always
did it
true.
By doing the same thing as the bad guy was about to do to somebody else, which on some level, even if you don't snap like she did, I mean, you still took a life. You know what I mean?
You know, I think back to the brutality when she hung the slavers on, you know, and crucified them. You know, yes, slavery is bad, but crucifying them is a little much, you know, that's so brutal, right? And people are okay with that, you know, that were watching the show, I guess, because they were bad. So let's just hang them for miles down, you know, and crucify them around the city that I'm trying to take over. You know, I was
like this desensitization.
I think so. Because she's
on some level
pretty. Yeah, she's pretty and has dragons, so she can't be bad, right?
Right.
You know, she's cute.
But it's weird how, like, you know, like how many characters could crucify a bunch of slavers up and down the coast and
not, like, yeah.
Yeah. Lose any respect, or, you know,
right. And so as somebody who's been, I also really like her character in the novels as well, because she is a complex character, and she's, unfortunately, she, you know, she is a Targaryen. Not everybody that's a Targaryen is crazy, but, you know, she's had a hell of a start to
life.
It
seems to run in the family.
It does. Well, because of the inbreeding is what they attributed that to. But she had a very rough start at life. You know, her parents were murdered. You know, she was, you know, sent into hiding with her totally crazy Targaryen brother. No, he was crazy.
Do they say in the show that it's because of the incest that is why?
Someone could correct me, but I'm pretty sure there's been some offhanded remark, you know, about them marrying each other. So about the insanity, what runs in that bloodline. With the Targaryens, which from where they came from, that's what you did, you know? You kept everything in the family. Plus, they were dragon riders, and they believed that only Targaryens could ride dragons.
Hey, whatever gets the hooker in your bathtub wet.
Pretty much,
I mean?
Right, right. But I think... It was a, you know, for all the things Daenerys has done that's been brutal. And I've been one that cheered her on. Like, you know, when her dragons were young and she was trying to buy the Unsullied. You know, I couldn't stand the man who, you know, had the Unsullied. He was a horrible piece of shit. You know, he hated women. He slaved these people.
Right.
And she tricked him when he took a hold of Drogon and Drogon burned him. You know, and the camera is panning her and you see her face and like she's just like looking like, yeah, I am the one. You know, she was so proud of herself, you know, smug. And I'm like, they kept showing you, like, this person, as much as she is intelligent, lovely, you know, she loves the people around her inner circle, she is capable of extreme brutality.
Well, I think those that have the criticism that, you know, it seemed unrealistic, if they rewatch knowing where it's knowing what's coming, it'll be a lot more evident.
They will see that.
Yeah.
Right. And I know a lot of people criticize the fact that Tyrion made a little bit of a speech about that to Jon, you know, justifying them following her. You know, the brutality that she had showed, we're not against good people per se, you know. No, I mean, she brutalized and had murdered slavers to take control of the Dothraki. She burned them alive. You know, were the Dothraki good? No, but you know, that whole culture was messed up from top to bottom. So instead of doing something, you know, a little bit less drastic, she locks them in and burns them all alive so she can be in control of the Dothraki. So I'm like, weren't y'all paying attention?
Right.
What is happening? I mean, you know, yes, she walks out naked and looking pretty as shit, and like looking at all her admirers down there, like looking at him and stuff. But I'm like, she literally just burned a bunch of people alive, and everybody's like, yes. And I'm like, no, that's not good. That's not good. That's messed up. That is messed up.
Right.
But it made exciting TV, though, an exciting story.
Oh, for sure. It's weird. I feel like she gets a lot more of a pass on a lot of things throughout that show.
Everything? Everything?
It's crazy because up until like you mentioning it, I had forgotten about the scene when she tricks the owner of the Unsullied. But there are so many like great parts of that show. That
there is.
I mean, like you were saying, like you're getting like a movie every week.
You are. Yeah, you are. And you will, if you don't watch it over and over, you will forget. You know, I actually love that scene very much when she does trick the owner of the Unsullied, you know, because he's speaking in the old Valyrian tongue and acting like she's just so stupid. And she also frees, who turns out to be her best friend, Missende, you know, in that scene. But, you know, at the same time, you know, she has a man burned alive, but she also gives them a choice. She's not, at that point, she's not threatening the Unsullied. Like, if you don't follow me, right, then I'll kill you. Like she did later on throughout, you know, some of the episodes, but in later seasons. But, you know, her brutality started in the first season and it just got a little bit more, you know, to the point where Tyrion was the one who talked her out of burning the city while they were still in Meereen.
You know, I feel like there's a good analogy there just in terms of, we were talking about it earlier, just how, like, corruption affects somebody. Yes. And that it's
in
like
power.
A slow drip and then all at once at the same time. But it is almost, like, not noticeable how it's progressing.
They did it very well. Right. They did it very well, I think, with her, because on the one hand, you want to cheer Daenerys on because she was slave. She had a horrible life start. You know, her parents brutally murdered, you know, her brother abused her, sold her, right? And so you want to cheer this person on because she's not going to stand there and just be this victim, right? But at the same time, and those who like have been, I think, watching this for several years, you start to notice a lot of her brutality. I, for one, absolutely love the dragons. I can sit and watch every dragon scene on Game of Thrones. I sent you a link to the videos where I just want to watch the dragon scenes, nothing else, because I think they're just amazing. But yet, as a human being, I couldn't help but think about, you're burning people alive. This character is burning people alive. That is the most brutal thing you can do to someone. And, but yet people cheered it on, you know, they get to thinking, this is a good thing that she's killing these people and burning them alive. That's how twisted that this character and the way that the story went. You know, when she went after the Lannister army, right, when they were in the battlefield, that was one of the best battlefields I've ever seen in a movie or TV show, right? Battle scenes, when she came swooping in over the Dothraki, right, on Drogon, amazing, great scene. But on the other hand, she was burning those people alive. And does it get any more brutal than that? I don't think so.
Like, when you look back, like, none of that behavior is acceptable. And yet we watch it with popcorn, you know?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I can't wait to tune in for some more.
Right. I feel like one of the appeals and one of the things that really solidifies the connection with fans is that it very much shows time and time again that, like, a person's life is so much more than just any given moment.
Oh, absolutely.
Because you have people, you know, that, like, we were talking about Daenerys's story arc, that, you know, she starts as this timid and loving girl and ends as, like, complete opposite.
Right.
But you have other characters who find themselves, you know, that are bad. Trying to think here. I don't know that I would classify it necessarily for, like, Theon.
Love his character. I love his arc as a character. Another one is the Hound. You know,
yes.
Just a puppet, you know, of the throne, and was a vicious killer.
And the Mountain, both.
Yeah. Well, the Mountain never redeemed himself. He was just awful. So the whole way through. But the Hound did redeem himself.
I just meant a puppet of the throne.
Yeah, he was a puppet of the throne as well. But, you know, these characters, I think what I like about most of them, so many of them, is they're so complex. You know, they don't have that true, I'm the good guy or I'm the good girl here.
Right.
You know, there's just many shades of gray with most of these characters. You know, even John, who is probably the most saintly of all the characters, honestly. You know, he still murdered, you know, the woman he loved, you know, to save others.
Speaking of John, I mean, like, in the show's world, like, how many people looked at Jaime Lannister with disgust because of what he did to...
Right.
The king.
Kingslayer. That was his name. Kingslayer. Right?
John turns around, does the same damn thing to the next
one. To Daenerys. Right. Yeah. To Daenerys. And why did Jaime kill the king? Because the king went mad and was burning people alive. Not to say Jaime Lannister is a great guy, which he's not. His character is so likable, though, right?
Yeah.
But he did it because his father was probably going to be next for him. And he's literally just murdering people at will, or burning them alive, and wanting more and more wildfire to do it.
Right. That's kind of what John has the realization of being the future. You know?
Well, yeah.
Do something.
Well, right. She made a promise and a speech in those wonderful faith languages that they were going to do the same thing, the Winterfell, Dorne, and what she just did to King's Landing. Which was utterly destruction like never seen before. I mean, even Aegon, you know, the stories, they talked about Aegon the Conqueror in the show, which, you know, people will hear, I'm sure, more in this new prequel, which I wish that's what they would have done the prequel on. He didn't just burn cities like she did, you know. He kind of did what she did. He gave them a choice to be, let him be their king, you know, which she didn't give anybody a choice. She just burned it up. You know, she wanted them to fear her because they wouldn't love her. And she, I think it goes back to that little girl that we met, that young girl we met in the first season. She didn't have anyone to love her. Her brother didn't love her. She was property. And the people that she started freeing, the slaves, they loved her, you know, and they propped her up. And she didn't have that in Westeros. And that really, I think, was really good. I love how they did do that, though, when they showed. And Emilia Clarke's a good actress, and she showed her disdain and her hurt and her pain for the way she was treated in Westeros. So people who didn't see it coming, don't know if they were really paying attention.
Well, I think it goes back to just what we were saying about how the show is just It's about life and humans and the way that people interact.
What do you do for power? What would you do for power? What would you do for that greed, right? You know, what lengths will you go to save people that you care about? You know, then that's basically what this story is mostly truly about. The lengths that people will go to save others, and the lengths people will go to for power. And so that's what the Game of Thrones was. It was about power and nothing more. And what hatched from the greed of that power was an amazing story that we got to watch. You know, everybody thought it was Cersei. You know, he came up with this great scheme when it was actually Littlefinger, because he wanted power.
Wait, what?
Who came up with the great scheme that we came in the very first season, what sent Ned Stark off, what pretty much ripped the Stark family apart, was the lie that the Lannisters killed Jon Arryn. That was all a lie. Littlefinger did all that to manipulate his chess pieces in a struggle for the Game of Thrones. Didn't you catch that?
How is it every time I talk to you about this damn show, you seem to slip something in that just completely rocks my understanding of it to the core?
Well, if you think back in the first season, right?
No, I'm remembering that. Yeah. Like, but I didn't put that together that
he hatched that.
Like, that lie literally did it.
He made the lie. Because he knew, too, that the Game of Thrones was nothing but made up of stories. Aegon didn't really, like, you know, melt all those swords, 1,000 swords to the Iron Throne. They were all stories, and he made up a story, a lie, to set that wheel in motion, which eventually led to the destruction of most of the Starks, unfortunately.
Yeah, it's interesting that, for as smart as he was, he didn't play some of his cards better.
I know. I think when he got up into the north, that's when he messed up. Oh, the north, yeah. Remembers. The north remembers.
Real bad.
Yeah. You know, here's where, at least in the show, because none of this has played out yet in the books, Littlefinger messed up because he didn't realize he was coming up against the three-eyed raven, right? He saw Bran as a crippled person in a wheelchair, right? And that's what they said. He was a crippled lord, you know, useless, right? And he had no idea. Yeah, he had no idea. He was coming up against the magic and the weird shit that happens in the north, right? He didn't know that. So that was where his plan failed. He thought he had this in a home run until he came up into the weird magical shit that's going on in the north. And that was his undoing.
Well, I mean, not even just the shit that he encounters, but like when he makes the deal with the Boltons, mm-hmm. or whatever. Like, why the fuck is he trying to get that house?
Why does he want that house?
Yeah, what are the
Boltons or Winterfell?
Boltons.
They were just a means to him getting what he wanted.
Well, right, he but was like, going why choose that house? Like,
because they have no scruples, for one thing, like none.
They have no scruples because they ain't got shit. Like, they don't do, like, if you look at the map, it's not really close to the north.
It's not, but Lord Bolton was definitely a formidable figure. He sided with the Lannisters and helped take down the Starks at the Red Wedding. He was part of that. So that's making a deal with Lord Bolton, because Lord Bolton wanted more and more and more. It is greed. They just have all this greed, these characters. And since he was a party to what happened to, you know, Catelyn Stark and Robb Stark and his wife, it would make sense to definitely make an ally of the Boltons after what they've done. So Littlefinger, you know, the story was actually pretty good, and I'm hoping to see if they go that way in the novels too.
He's then little, like, why does he withhold all that information from Sansa when she's
using her to
increase her numbers or whatever?
You know? He was using her is all. He kind of like loved her because of the love he had for his mother or her mother.
Yeah.
But he didn't love her enough to give up power, make no mistake. You know, he wasn't going to give up his game, his chess game of trying to get to the throne. You know, that's what he sold her. He sold her to the Boltons.
Yeah.
That's not love.
Right.
Well, knowing what would happen to her.
I mean, and we see how she gets, I mean, game right. as well for her. Better for her
brutalized.
Than for him.
Right.
Her story arc is one that I love as well. From going yes. from being so Southern
Belle, yeah.
hiring to woman of the North.
I know. Who would have thunk, right?
Right.
She was such a little brat. Remember back in the first season? She was just a brat. Just,
probably my least favorite character.
She was everybody's least favorite characters because she just whined about wanting to marry Prince, that she liked lemon cakes and blah, blah, blah. And Arya was like annoying to her. We're like, oh my God. You know, she's that annoying little lady that's a total brat, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So she went from that to being the Queen of the North. That's quite a journey.
Slightly off topic, but on the subject, Sophie Turner looks great in both atmospheres.
Yes, I like her in real life better. She looks better in real life.
Oh, I mean, she looked great in the South with like the Southern guards, but like I also like.
Oh, up north.
She's like presented as like the Warden of the North or whatever. Right. Like, she looks just as badass in all the Northern garb.
I think too. She looks way better in the Northern garb. You know, the Northern garb, they look like, you know, they don't stand their shit, man. They got like buckles and some leather. And so, like, they got the wardrobe people, like they definitely like said, no, you know, people in the North, we come correct, right? We come correct. So I do like the wardrobes that they chose, especially in the last couple of seasons for the people up North.
I was watching, something on the wardrobe, and they were talking about how Sansa's crown mm-hmm. that she wears is similar to Cersei's
mm-hmm.
to like symbolize that she took all of like the good qualities of Cersei.
Right.
In terms
Hello, everybody.
Of- Hello.
Arya could chase you, and she'd catch you because you're fat. Okay. But yes. She learned a lot from Cersei. She learned a lot from the experiences that she had when she was a hostage, you know, in King's Landing with those people. I never thought that, you know, I don't know if the books are going to go that way and make her a queen or not, because you know, she's, you know, I keep going back to what Ned Stark said, you know, those who pass the judgment should wield the sword. You know, so it's, you know, Sansa's not that kind of a badass. So I don't know if I like the North.
Yeah, that quote is so good.
Ned Stark, that character, you had him for one book, right, in the novels. That's it. You had him for one season in the
show.
How
many novels are there?
4 or 5. I can't remember now. Because, like I said, it's branched out now, and you've got the Targaryen stuff. So, but you had him for that one season in the show. But yet, everything he said or did is so prevalent in the later seasons still, you know, the impact that one character made on his children and even on others, because of how they, you know, they spoke of his honor and all this and that is so evident. I really love how, you know, the story was written that Ned Stark was going to make this big impact on everyone. And in the show, it's written the same way that he makes this big impact on everyone. So he had the best lines, you know, winter is coming and I'm pro Stark, as you can see.
What is that?
This is a beer tap for when I drink my ale. I can go like this, and I have the dire wolf.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's what it looked like, but I couldn't tell. Oh, you're all garbed out.
I am. I'm missing my, I have a bottle, and I have it from a keychain, too. I have blankets, but it's not cold enough to have a blanket on. But, yeah, I love.
Goodness, the heat.
Show. Yeah.
Some of the criticisms of the ending don't necessarily have to do with anything that is show specific. It's more in terms of the books. Mm-hmm. One of the things is that there were some prophecies that went unfulfilled in how people died.
Yeah, you're really going to have to
What do you think is going to be the result for that in terms of the book's ending? Just knowing that George R.R. Martin gave the green light for how the show ended. Do you see him kind of ending things the same way?
I think he'll take a definite, way more creative and detailed path to get there. The prophecies in the novels are very important, okay? And they touched on a little of the prophecies in the show.
Well, until I was watching the, I can't remember what it was on it. I didn't even realize there were,
prophecies.
I would have assumed there were prophecies just from like the way the show is. It sounds like something Maesters would collect.
They didn't focus really big on the prophecies except for Cersei. You know, there's a big deal about her prophecy. You know, she was told by a mage, which is a witch, that she would bear 3 golden children, and I'm paraphrasing here, you know, but basically they would all die. They would wear golden shrouds, right? And she would be a queen and replaced by a queen more beautiful than her. Technically, that happened. Daenerys was the queen for a minute.
But didn't it say she would die by the hand of somebody?
Her little brother. Her little brother.
Yeah, so they thought Tyrion was going to kill her.
Tyrion play a hand in her death? Didn't Tyrion help Daenerys get to Westeros? Didn't Tyrion Barker?
I mean, like the, I don't know. It feels like that's a loose straw grasp, but you know what I mean.
Even in the show, I really don't, because Tyrion, which is the reason he became her hand, was her saving grace to getting the ships that she needed to go to Westeros. She wasn't doing anything over there in Meereen except causing a bunch of trouble and having everybody hate her and shit, right? You know, she's like fucking up some slavers, but she was not having a lot of success. And Tyrion came on the scene, and with him came Varys. And if it wasn't for them, right, would she even have the ship she needed? She burned some of the slavers' master ships, right? Which Tyrion suggested.
That right there is the point that I was thinking about, how Varys was like the straw that broke the camel's back, because both of the people that she came, or that came from King's Landing, you know, one had turned on her. Now Tyrion turns on everybody at some point. I feel like he's very,
Tyrion's a good man, and
he's my favorite character.
Mine too. And he truly did believe in her. But if you want to say that prophecy came true, he had a huge hand in Daenerys being in Westeros. He supported her. He became her hand.
Right. I feel like that would be the only way that you could make the prophecy true.
It is. When everything else happened, right? She lost her children because of her own greed, right? All of her children died. Okay. She was replaced by a queen, you can argue, is younger and more beautiful than her. Daenerys wasn't a queen for long, but she took the Iron Throne, right? She burned down King's Landing and became the number one person. She was queen until Jon killed her. So that prophecy was true. I know that a lot of people are really like, what's going on with the prophecy then of Azor Ahai, or however you say it, because everybody thought, well, that's Jon, right? And everybody thought it meant that Jon had to do something to kill the Night King, right? Which obviously didn't happen in the show. But I don't know if you even know what I'm referring to for that prophecy.
I don't.
What you remember when Melisandre, she went to Daenerys when Daenerys was at Dragonstone, and she was encouraging her to invite Jon Snow. And that's Melisandre's talking about the prophecy. Do you remember that when she showed up at Dragonstone in the middle of the night? Okay. Well, she's encouraging Daenerys to bring Jon Snow to Dragonstone because of the prophecy. The fire and ice needed to be brought together, right? So the prophecy is kind of interesting, and everybody thinks, at that point, everybody thinks Jon is the ice and she's the fire, Daenerys, right? So at that point, nobody realizes that Jon all by himself is fire and ice. And so that prophecy too kind of came through, because he had to stick a blade in the woman he loved to save the kingdoms. And although I don't think the show, and I could be wrong, but I don't think the show touched a lot on the old prophecies, which Rhaegar Targaryen believed in. And he believed it was his destiny to bring forth the prince that was promised. They do talk about that in the show. actually. And I know that even in the show, they show this scene. Do you remember in the birthing bed when Lyanna Stark was dying? Do you remember that?
No. I remember them talking about it, but I don't remember them showing it.
Oh, yeah. They showed young Ned Stark trying to get to her, and he had to fight, you know, these, you know, very reputable knights to get to her. Do you remember Bran seeing this in his histories when he becomes a
forever? Yes, now I remember. Yeah. Okay.
The first time Bran looks at this vision, he's seeing his father as a young man fighting one of the best swordsmen ever, right, in their histories, right? And he was referred to as the Sword of the Morning, okay? And in that scene in the tower, right, when Ned Stark goes up to his sister and, you know, she gives him the baby, he sets the sword down, and the symbol on that sword is a sun. And the prophecy was the prince that was promised was born under something about the sun, okay? Which they're showing us in that scene that this child is born with, and there's that symbol right there. So that prophecy, and I don't know how it's going to play out in the books, but with the show, you could kind of say it really did ring true, actually, because Melisandre tells Daenerys the prophecy, and Missandei said it can mean prince or princess, how it's translated, the prophecy. So, of course, Daenerys is conceited, and she's thinking it's her, right? That she's going to be the savior of everybody.
Right.
Right. Which, all along, it's Jon. You know, yes, hold on, the lights, I'm having some technical difficulties. It's really Jon that brought everybody together, right, to defeat the Night King, even though he didn't stick him with the dagger. It was somebody else. Nobody would even have been there had it not have been for Jon, right? They wouldn't have been battling it.
Now that you point out the sun on the sword.
The crest of the sword.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Being, like, the symbol that fulfilled that prophecy, I can definitely see then, like, Tyrion bringing her to Westeros being the meaning of the other prophecy. You know what I mean?
And I don't know that Tyrion actually knew those prophecies or believed in those. He didn't believe in prophecies. He didn't believe in things like that. You know, right. He read about them, but he didn't believe in that stuff. You know, he didn't believe in the White Walkers, even though they were with dragons. He didn't believe in the White Walkers. So I think he ended up there by accident because he killed his father and he got put on a ship and sent overseas and became a slave. But he believed in Daenerys to be the one to take down Cersei. He believed in her for that and that she would be a good queen. No, I don't think he believed in any type of prophecy. He still wasn't believing in this shit until he came across the White Walkers.
No, and I mean, he even kind of, he doesn't come right out and say, I don't believe in stuff like that, but it kind of alludes to it in the way that in the conversations he has with Jon in the first season.
Rumpkin snarks and whatever. Yeah, he doesn't believe in that sort of thing.
Now, some say that the mission to retrieve a White Walker to show Cersei was a dumb decision.
Was, but it made for some epic scenes.
It did. However, it can also be said, I mean, I hate when somebody points something out and then you can't unsee it and you can't, like, and watching that whole scene of them being surrounded and Daenerys coming to save them and then Jon not
favorite.
Jon would have just got on the fucking dragon.
I know.
Fight all these people off. Then she would have lost one of the dragons.
I have to say, that is like one of my favorite scenes is when in the music. Can we just give a shout out to the writer and composer of the Game of Thrones music? I mean, he is amazing. His music is incredible. And I'm probably slaughtering his name, but Rahman Awaldi. His music makes Game of Thrones for me. When she swoops in with that fire and the music that plays then, and like right up to the point where Drogon lands, I'm just like, I have goosebumps. That music is so fantastic. But yeah, let's go back to that decision. I'm really not sure I cared for that part of the story very much because Cersei's a cunt. Okay, can I say that? She's a fucking cunt. She doesn't care. Whatever kills you, she'll be happy with. Cersei doesn't care about anybody but Cersei, right? And she does love Jaime, you know, if you call that love. She does, in the baby that she's pregnant with. That's all, you know. I don't understand that part. And I think that was just, I don't know, kind of whack writing.
It just seems like there's a lot of, like, weird shit in there. Like, Gendry running all the way back there.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know how far they've
ever seen snow before. He's lived in the South all his life, and you think he's going to run all the way back, like, through that wilderness, carrying all that armor.
He didn't carry, I was going to say, he didn't really carry. They kept his hammer, and they said he'd be run faster without it.
Well, I just mean, like, the clothes to keep him warm is something he's used to.
I definitely thought that that was kind of silly. I mean, yes, Gendry's young and able and strong and I don't know.
Damn.
But I don't know how far he really ran. I don't know how far they actually got past the wall, to be honest, because they never really showed us how far they went. But yeah, it was all, the whole thing, if you want to pick it apart, was a little far-fetched that they were able to get a raven to Daenerys in the first place, right? And to have her get there in time. I mean, how long were they stranded out on that rock thing? Or the frozen, I don't know that either. They never really showed how long they were out there. So, I don't know. I thought it was a little bit silly, but I'm going to love that scene anyway, just because of how she comes in and saves the day.
Oh, I mean, I love it. It's just like, see, I don't know. I don't know how it is for other people, but like when I see something I don't like in a show, I get angry at the characters, not the writers.
Well, yeah, most people do because they forget somebody wrote this shit. They're just acting and doing what they're supposed to, right?
Right.
So, yeah, people do get
like,
mad at characters.
But, like, hating it is part of the reason I enjoy it. You know what I mean? Like,
you're not the only one that had that reaction to why didn't Jon just get on the dragon, which, you know, I realized they tried to show they weren't the White Walkers, but they were the Whites. They were like getting ready to swarm Drogon like bugs, right? Which we saw what happened when they were able to climb up onto Drogon, you know, in the Battle of the Night King. You know, we saw that enough of them can take the dragon down, right? So I get it. But it's still, it was great. I loved her saving them. And I loved his uncle coming to his rescue because I wondered, like, where'd he go? Right? He was with Bran and them, and then, like, we didn't see him again.
Benjen would be a great character to get a spinoff series.
Oh, man, I'd love to see what happened to him. I won't watch the scene, though, when her dragon dies. I'll just fast forward over that. I was just like, oh, them poor baby dragons were locked up for so long, and they just got their taste of sweet freedom and shit, and got to go out in the world, and then he's dead. So I don't like that scene.
Yeah. I like that. Oh, no, never mind. See, it's all a blur now. I was about to say they put in the credits, no dragons were harmed in the mayhem, but they didn't. It was Harry Potter. It's all starting
to... merge.
Game of
Thrones rips your heart out, and that's what it's, you know, the Red Wedding. I have never seen something so awful, I swear.
Red Wedding!
Awful. You know, that's the kind of scene that I wouldn't even want to watch again, honestly.
Yeah.
You know, it was...
You know, speaking of going back to dumb decisions for a moment, the only dumber decision than to knock it on that dragon was Jaime Lannister thinking he was going to fucking take Daenerys out.
Yeah, that was pretty bad. Right. Just because the dragon had landed doesn't mean the dragon can't breathe fire. Haven't we been watching him burn everything to shit for the last 15 minutes? Okay,
right.
Of course. Burn your ass too. Yeah,
right.
That was dumb. You're right. That was dumb.
I feel like it was his past success in that kind of mission that made him overzealous and not thinking.
Yes,
straight.
Very arrogant, and I think he was absolutely blown away by the destruction that he had just, you know, but he just witnessed. I don't think it was his arrogance per se, but just like, look at what this dragon has done to our army. Look at what this destruction has caused. This must stop, right? So, but yeah, and he was willing to die to stop it. You know, so I think you have to give him, you know, a little credit. He was willing to sacrifice his life to stop that.
No, you know who you need to give credit to?
Is Braun.
Braun.
Absolutely.
Now, I didn't know that the actor that played Braun dated Lena Headey.
Right. And they said that they could not be in the on set together.
Yeah.
Right.
I wonder.
Very ugly breakup. So
there aren't any interactions between those two characters in the books.
Not yet, I don't think. You have to keep in mind the books stopped so long before we see so much of Game of Thrones.
And that's the other thing too. The fans of the books, I can imagine, are a little pissed off that, like, after the series ends, George R.
We're still gonna have a book.
Actually, I think there might be one more after Winds of Winter.
There's supposed to be one more after Winds of Winter, and it would be amazing if he finished Winds of Winter.
Well, originally Winds of Winter was supposed to be the last one, wasn't it?
Right. I don't know. I give up. You know, I'm not even going to think about the books anymore until it drops, because this is ridiculous. You know, I understand a person is busy, but he had a vision for where the story was going. So I'm not sure why these books aren't finished after all these years. So because I'm no spring chicken, I'm not even going to think about the books now, because I'll just have to go with what they gave me on the show and hope I live. And I also hope George R. Martin lives, because he's no spring chicken either, to finish the story, because the book story is so different than the show story.
Yeah. I feel like there's an unfairness that's understandable but sad when something blows up like that, and like, now, like, finish it now. But you're right, on some level, I mean, I'm no writer, but I've done some writing, and like, when you're writing things in a fictional sense, like, you just know how things go sometimes.
Right.
A majority right. of the time. I mean, I understand there are tough decisions to make at points, but like, Jesus, the amount of time it's been. How long has it been since the last one came out?
Oh, God. It's been 10 years, maybe? I don't know. There hasn't been one since the show, I'll tell you that.
And it's like, well, the expectation, you know, for it to be good is only increasing.
Right. I was going to say, like, there's little other short stories, you know, and there's also Fire and Blood, you know, and there's two books with the Targaryens, actually, which are fascinating, but they're not, it's not our story, right? We want to know what happened to Jon. You know, last we know, Jon's being killed, okay, in the novels, you know, and so the show definitely took things a different way.
Is Jon being dead the, when it happens in the show the first time before he's brought back? Is that where the books leave off?
Yes. So we don't know what happens beyond there in the books, but John.
That had to be a crazy reveal to people who read the books to see that he didn't really die, like in the show.
Like, well, no, because the books are so different. And this is where I said I was disappointed in some of the magical elements they cut from the show. All of the Starks were wargs in the books. You know, they were like Bran. Bran could warg into things. They were all that way. It wasn't just Bran. You know, although it didn't touch on Sansa at all. Arya could sense her wolf in the books. Thousands of miles away. You know, when they would dream, they would sense each other. The Starks and these wolves were so connected, right? John could warg into ghosts. You know, they were like one and the same at times. Like, you know, in the show, it showed Bran doing that with Summer, his wolf. All the kids were capable of that. And they didn't show that on the show. So in the books, you know, the big thing is he didn't die because he jumped in. He sent himself into ghosts. You know, his soul or spirit or whatever you want to call it, went into ghost. So in the show, they use Melisandre to bring him back, you know, because that was what those red priests do. They bring shit, people back or whatever they are.
Now, I remember us talking a while ago, and you had mentioned that there was one of the big differences was that Kat doesn't come back as a ghost.
No, in the books, she's called Lady Stoneheart. And it's magic, right? And Arya, I think, has something to do with this. It's been so long since I've read that. But instead of being able to bring her back, like, you know, Don Darien, the Red Priest, you know how that he came back and had all those lives, the guy who saved Arya?
Yeah.
You know, they waited too long, I guess is a good way to put it, to bring Catelyn back. And so she came back very gross and kind of decomposed and filled with rage and vengeance. So they cut that, you know, from the show, which I can understand them cutting that from the show. That's okay. I'm okay with that. I just wish they would have showed, you know, the abilities that Jon had, you know, and Arya had, you know, Sansa, nah. You know, but showed those abilities, why Jon and Ghost, you know, could just know each other. And I get it. The wolves were expensive and difficult to work with, you know, but I think that was missing a lot. I really think I missed that probably the most, that part of these characters that you ended up loving in these stories, part of what makes them is not there on the show. And Bran, what's your thoughts on Bran? Everybody's so mad that he's the king at the end of the season.
It makes sense.
Like, everything that Westeros has gone through, do they really trust a regular person to handle things now? You know what I mean?
Right. But not only in that respect, I can understand why people would be upset just in the sense that Bran would be a drastically different leadership than everything before it.
I look at it this way. Who you want running shit?
Right.
The dude who can control possibly the dragon? Because right. He's in a powerful warg, right? And you still have a dragon out there. It's probably pissed off somewhere, right? Wouldn't you want the guy in charge, the guy who could actually take control of that dragon? I mean, think about it. He's a powerful warg.
Makes
pretty
sense.
Sure he could warg the dragon if he needed to. But
well, I know a lot of people brought that up as a reason for why it didn't make sense that the Night King got the dragon.
Oh, when he got the first dragon?
Yeah, because then they were like, well, why didn't Bran just warg into it?
Did Bran know that that was happening at that moment? I don't know. We don't really see what Bran's doing when that happens, do we?
Well, not like when it happens, but after it becomes part. Like, can he not warg into it after it's been...
I don't know. It's not a living creature.
Or whatever.
Really. Right. It's not really alive, is it? It's undead or whatever.
Yeah.
It's being animated by some other type of magic, but I don't know if Bran can work into that. So I don't know. Everything he works into is alive. You know, Hodor, his wolf, you know, those are living things.
Hodor.
Oh, Hodor. Love Hodor.
Now, I know this might be an answer to what you were saying earlier about why they all weren't wargs is obviously that would have been a lot of establishing stuff to like be in like the first season, and the CGI to create the direwolves is incredibly expensive.
I know, and that's probably exactly why they didn't do it.
Well, I know that they said that's why Ghost didn't kill someone. I can't remember. Ghost is supposed to go into battle with him.
Well, I know they left Ghost out of one season altogether. The season before last, I think, we never even saw Ghost the entire time, which is, to book fans, a travesty, because Jon and Ghost were like this. They didn't separate, like, ever. They were always together. Which, I get it. They were spending the bulk of the money on the dragons.
Yeah, but I can't. Well, no, I just mean like they would have had to show all of that warg ability in the first season when they didn't have the money to spend it.
But they could have. They could have, because those are just dogs in the first season, right? aren't these big ass direwolves? They were basically, they used dogs for the scenes. So they could have shown their abilities. And I did read D&D, the right, they didn't want to because they didn't want to bring all that magic to it. Had nothing to do with their budget. It was their decision to cut some of the magic out, is what it was.
Well, that's
so bad. It does suck because it's like, damn it, you know, that really like enhanced, I guess, or made the Stark kids like even more interesting.
I feel like that was a sad decision just because I feel like they felt they had to do that to make it appealing, not realizing that it would be appealing despite that because of how strong the story was.
Right. You wouldn't, you know, you don't know going into it. They might have thought that, and maybe they really believed that was too much magic, but it's not like they were just constantly hanging out in the stories, like just warging shit, you know, it's just, really, you know, they bonded them in this show to their wolves anyway, but in the books, the bond was way beyond just a bond that you have with a pet, you know, they could be one and the same. So I like that aspect about it, and I missed that in the show quite a bit, but I mean, it all worked out the way I guess it should. I don't know, I guess that, you know, the author is going to end the show. I just think we'll see a lot more interesting character development when in the books is all. That's what I think.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I can't think of a situation where the books aren't better than the movie.
Dances with Wolves is the only one I know of. I will always maintain the movie is better than the book.
Who wrote the book?
I cannot remember. I read it maybe 25 years ago. And I didn't want to read the book again, but I watched the movie anytime I get the chance.
Who's in it?
Kevin Costner. Oh my God, it's won like a million Academy Awards. It's one of the most perfect movies I think ever made.
Game of Thrones, I mean, damn, taking Emmys, jeez.
Yeah.
Sorry, you saying the Academy Awards made me think of that.
Yeah, like, people are actually angry that they won Emmys, and I'm like, what are you kidding? Okay, so you don't like the way the story went. Can you deny that the music wasn't incredible, right? The music was just gorgeous. And the
effects were amazing.
The effects were amazing. Absolutely amazing. You know, all those little whiners who complained that they couldn't see, you know, the battle at Winterfell. I'm like, I don't know. Why didn't you just turn your lights off then? Because I thought being like them in the dark with just fire to illuminate it instead of the fake movie lights was brilliant. Because for me, that put me in that scene, fucking freezing my ass off in the freaking dark about to fight the most evil shit ever, right? I mean, that made it even more intense for me.
Because in order to watch it live, you had to forego your heating bill to pay for HBO. So you were freezing in the dark as well.
Yeah. Oh, I've always had HBO. I will go for a steak or whatever it takes. I've always had HBO. But that scene itself, you know, when people bitched about it being too dark, I'm just like,
I thought it was the whole episode.
I didn't find it too dark. I don't know. Me, but
I only knew about it like the next day when I saw online that people were bitching about it.
Same, because it looked fine to me. It looked dark, but I could see everything.
Right.
You know, and we do have a decent TV, but I also am not watching the show with a bunch of lights on either. One mood light is fine. I absolutely love the scene. And I know people were like, well, you know, the battle was so lame. You know, if you would send in, you know, their soldiers like into the enemy. It's like, okay, all they were really trying to do was lure the Night King to where that they could defeat him. They never had a hope to defeat the army, right? That was never the plan. I'm like, this, the people who are making these complaints, are they actually not listening to what's being said? I don't think they're listening to anything.
Plus, I mean, isn't the understanding that, like, if the Night King dies, they all do?
That was the whole plan. They were trying to lure the Night King to the Godswood. So when people started bitching, why would you send in your like the Dothraki first? Did they not just listen to the plan about how they were going to try to do this? It's like, I think a lot of the complaints is half of it is people aren't listening and they're not paying attention. They're on their phones, actually not even watching or listening to what's being done. And then they complain when they don't understand why something was done.
Well, I feel like part of that is the people that are just there for the spectacles as opposed to the story don't pay attention when it's the dialogue that is explaining why things are happening this way.
You're right. They don't want to listen to that. They just want to see action. They just want to see the action.
Right.
But I definitely agree with some of the criticism that some of the characters that were in that battle probably shouldn't have survived. You know, Sam, he shouldn't even been out there. He should have been down with the women and children. Just because he killed a White Walker a long time ago doesn't mean he's got any battle skills.
You know, but can we give it to the man for killing that White Walker?
I'm going to always give Sam props for killing that White Walker. He was terrified beyond terrified, and the actor did such a great job, right? But he was determined to save Gilly, right? And her baby, as scared as he was, and he did it anyway, and just overcame that fear.
The Maester tells Jon in one of the earlier seasons, and he repeats it to Tyrion in the last episode, that love is the death of duty. Mm-hmm. But I feel like in some situations, love is also like the birth of duty. In that situation, you know what I mean? Like,
yes, he already fell for her
love
by then.
For Gilly,
right?
Like, if he would have been alone in the woods, he would have died.
Right, but he found the courage because he loved her and wanted to protect her and her son.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I love Sam. He's one of my favorite characters up there for sure.
I love Sam too. When we were talking, and I had said that most of the characters aren't just the good guys. He's a good guy. Okay. There's no shades of gray with Sam. You know, he is a good human. He's one of the few truly good humans in the story. You know, because think about it. There's not a lot of just really good people in this story, but Sam is one of them.
Right. There really aren't. But yeah. I think that
John is. I mean, yes, he has to kill for battle, but he is good. He really is good.
But it's so interesting that in the end, he ends up almost identical to Jaime Lannister.
He ended up almost worse than Jaime Lannister. Jaime Lannister got to live and be the head of the Golden Cloaks and live in the palace. John was banished. You know, which, say what you want. John had always said, you know, he was honored and humbled when they made him king of the north. That's one thing. That's his birth. That's where he thinks he was born at first, right? That's where he's always known, the north. The north is his home, right?
Right.
So, yes, but he didn't want to rule. He didn't want to be a leader in power. He wanted a life, and he'd been denied that his whole existence. He was a bastard. Unwanted, he went to the wall. So in the one way, John did win what he wanted all along, which was his freedom. Yeah, it's a kind of shitty way to get it because it's mighty cold up there, but you know what, he's fine with it. He was fine with it. You know, but I want to go up there and all that cold and snow. No, but he's fine with it. And he gets to be with his boy Ghost, and you know, Ghost is a northern direwolf. He needs to be up north, you know, and the direwolves are. So, I mean, it wasn't that bad, you know, what happened to him. It wasn't like he was put in some prison cell to rot. He got to go off and be a free man, finally, and live his life on his own terms.
Right. Ironic that the actor would marry the wildling.
Yeah, I thought that was so cute that they met on the set and fell in love.
Right.
They're having a baby.
Meanwhile, yeah. There are other characters that can't even be on the same set together.
Right, which, you know, I understand. I'm assuming something very bad happened, so, you know, just make sure we don't have to film any scenes together. So,
well,
you know,
seeing what Cersei does to people, I can only imagine what that man went through.
Well, I would say Lena's probably a very good actress.
I need to send you a video of do you know who Tig Notaro is?
Who?
Tig Notaro.
I've heard the name.
She's a lesbian comedian who's very like deadpan and like not very pop culture, not with it, like doesn't know a whole lot of stuff about it. Mm-hmm. And she does a show called Under a Rock with Tig Notaro,
mm-hmm.
where she has celebrities come on and she interviews them to figure out who they are because she doesn't know who famous people are.
Oh, okay.
And does it with Lena Headey, and it's super funny.
I remember watching Lena Headey in a Headey. I don't even know how you say her name. I remember watching her in a film years ago where she played this lesbian shop owner of this flower shop, and she like fell in love with this chick who was married to a man. And I didn't really know who she was as an actress, but I just remember thinking, you know, she's gonna, you know, do some phenomenal things, I think, because I really liked her as an actress. And then, you know, ironically enough, it was Tyrion Lannister. You know, who plays Tyrion Lannister, he's the one that told her about she should audition for Game of Thrones. So, because they're actually real life friends.
Thank God. So, thank God he did.
Because I can't even picture now a more perfect Cersei, honestly. Yeah. I mean, I really didn't have a vision of her in my mind when I was reading the novels like I did Ned Stark and Sean Bean. And it's probably because of my freaking love of like Lord of the Rings. I just knew that he had to be Ned Stark. There just could be nobody else to be Ned Stark. I mean, even the way the dialogue was written in the novel sounded like him. So, but I didn't have a visual of like anybody else, right? So I didn't visualize Cersei, like, and so I thought, man, she's perfect, actually. Because you almost want to like Cersei sometimes, right? This teeny sometimes. Yeah. And then you realize she's such a...
That was a struggle I had watching it. Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, she tries to give Ned Stark his out, right? She tries to make it so that Ned isn't killed. She knows what a disaster that's going to be. And she, at the same time, she wanted Bran to be killed. At the same time, she didn't, because he was a child. And she still had that love for children, or, you know, like her children. She was upset with Jaime that he did it, but glad that he did it and pushed him out of the window at the same time, right? And in the novel, Cersei's the same. There's some things that's almost kind of likable about her. And then she just does shit. You're like, nah, I hate this bitch. Which is a great character. It makes for a terrific character.
Well, she was ranked the number one TV and film villain. The Night King was ranked 43.
Oh yeah, and I can see why.
I mean,
wow, that's because we didn't really get to know him. Like, we get to know Cersei, right? Over all the years. We got to make her tick. We got to see what broke her. As far as the show's concerned, we didn't really get to know the Night King. Now, what's his real purpose anyways? What's with the fucking symbols? Are we? Guess we just don't get to know that, right? So that was a huge disappointment.
Why won't, like, you talk, why are you setting us up
these seasons? Right. But that was a huge disappointment in the final season. Like, we don't get to know what any of that meant. Okay, well, that sucks.
Well, do you think any of that will be laid out in the prequel?
No, I don't think so, unless they are talking about histories or something from way, way, way back, because the prequel is going to be after the Last Long Night. So I doubt we're going to even see any White Walkers. I don't even know if we're going to make it up to the North in the prequel, because the North didn't have a huge impact on the Targaryens until, well, there were some points where the North had an impact. I just don't know if that show is going to showcase any of it. I don't think we're going to see anything about the White Walkers in that show.
Do you think it'll be shot more like a historical, like kind of in the way that Fire and Blood was written?
I don't know. I don't know if you could shoot it that way and have it be, I don't know if people would want to see it that way, or if they want a story, you know, like with actual plots and everything. I don't know if you can do it in a historian type writing or not.
What I said earlier, I'm wondering if even telling a story will kind of have the historical feel, just because it's based on a world we already know.
Right. I don't know. I was disappointed that they weren't going to do The Long Night. That was one of the projects that was a possibility. They had cast Naomi Watts and some other big names to it. And that was going to be The Long Night, you know, that you hear them talking about, you know, especially in the North in Game of Thrones, but that got scrapped for whatever reason in favor of House of the Dragon.
How long, or what do you see as the longevity of the franchise of Game of Thrones? I mean, like I mentioned earlier, Harry Potter is now coming up on 20 years. We're just hitting 10 years now with Game of Thrones, but there is just as much opportunity for things like merchandising and whatnot to make it a profitable engine beyond the entertainment. Do you think that it will, like right now it seems like the show is kind of like a bonus to the books. Do you see it becoming something where the show is kind of like they build things around it? You know what I mean?
Does that make sense? Well, of course they had all these ideas of what they were going to do with the success of the show. There were multiple prequels in development of the show. Okay. Obviously you can't do a sequel because all the people aren't going to come back, but there were multiple prequels in development. And I had noticed with the backlash that Game of Thrones received for the last season, a lot of the ideas got scrapped. So they are going to go forward with House of the Dragon. I'm almost not sure if they can continue that momentum because of season 8. As much as we like to say, you know, people are whining, they need to get over it. People didn't like it.
Why was it canceled?
What, that one prequel?
No, Game of Thrones.
It wasn't canceled. They decided.
Why did they decide to end? Like, do you think it would have been better if they would have had 9 seasons?
I think it probably would have given them a little bit more time to develop. Well, you know what? I'm gonna scratch that. I don't know that it would have been better because the problem, I think, is where people started to see a difference in the show is when they ran out of books. How easy would it be to have a book to go off for you to like take the direction of your show, right? With amazing dialogue, you know, and then they didn't have that source material anymore.
I think that's kind of, you know, what I said in the beginning, how in order for fantasy to work, you really have to have something that is so massive that it like creates this world. And I think I don't know that even with as much as they had leading up to the point where they were kind of just like, you're on your own now. From that point on, you're right. There wasn't enough time for them to come up with something that wasn't as well thought out.
Right. I just think, and I could be so wrong on this, I just feel that when they ran out of the source material, it lost a little bit of that intelligence and smart dialogue that we were used to. And like, you know, in the other seasons, I still liked it. Don't get me wrong. I loved it, in fact, but it did change a little. And even though I'm sure that they were given direction, you know, by George R. Martin, or like where they wanted the show to go, they didn't have that original flavor. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like the books had for those other seasons. It just had that original flavor, the dialogue, the storylines, you know, where they could kind of just cut things versus having to come up with things all by themselves. It didn't feel quite the same. And I don't know what's going to happen with this prequel. And I think that a lot of these other projects probably got scaled back until they see how is the world going to receive this? Right. How are they going to receive this? Because the backlash from season 8 was so brutal, right? That, you know, you've got millions of fans who refuse to ever watch it again, you know, that they want nothing to do with it. So I think we'll probably know more.
Which is so crazy to me because, like, I didn't think it was bad at all. And if I would have thought it was bad, I would not think it would be bad enough that I would never watch it again.
Me neither. And I told you, I don't have time to watch something so massive all the time, but I'll literally pull up my favorite scenes on YouTube and watch it because I miss Game of Thrones, actually. You know, yeah, there were some things that were, you know, should they probably, in my opinion, they should have never had Sam out in the battle in the first place, and he survived by plot armor only, right? He shouldn't even have been out there. He should have been with the women and children. So I don't even know why they did that, to be honest with you. It made no sense. Am I going to always be salty on how I never got to figure out how the fuck Arya got through all those whites and shit to kill the Night King? Hell yeah. I need.
Right. Oh my God. Thank you for pissing the fuck off.
I need some more substance than that, right? She can't just springboard out of nowhere, right? And the thing that pissed me off is, why did you do it that way? She's a freaking trained assassin, right?
Right.
So she knows how to make and change faces with the magic that she learned over in Bravosi or wherever, right? So why the fuck didn't you have her do that then?
Right.
Take a white face. Yes, it's gross and rotted. Right. But, you know, Arya, she's strong. She could handle it. You know, she's wearing funky faces anyway. So why didn't they just do that? That would have made so much more sense than the way that it was done. And I just feel like there was a lot of sloppiness in the script that didn't make a lot of sense, you know, this final script. I mean, I give everybody kudos. They worked so hard to make it, but there was some sloppiness in the execution of the story, for sure. Big time.
Yeah.
Big time. That was one of them, you know, that was just, you know, was I excited that she did it? Sure. But then I was like, well, how'd she do that? It right? Almost, there's like whites everywhere.
It almost, it's almost like when they ran out of source material, they started to rely on the spectacles more than.
Agreed. Same. You know, it's almost like they didn't follow their own story. You know, to have Arya do what she was trained to do, right? That's great. She is an assassin, but, you know, why didn't you have her take a face? You know, you talk about this and talk about this and all the other seasons, and then when the time comes where she needs to be hidden and to be secretive, you don't have her take a face.
Right.
It doesn't make any sense at all.
And
not at all. I mean, and I can,
to the point of it being gross, I mean, if you're wearing somebody else's face, I don't think who is what makes that gross. You know what I mean? Like,
some kind of magic involved in that. We saw that. So she could just use the same kind of magic. Because the voice and everything changes when she does that, right? So, and as far as people thinking, oh, well, it should have been John that stuck him, you know, that did it. You know, yeah, they'd been leading us up to John being the one the whole time. And maybe he will be in the novels. I don't know. I have a feeling that he probably will be in the novels. And she is just the one that takes the vengeance on the Stark family. But I could be wrong about that. But, you know, it's fine if you were going to do that. But I think it could have been done a lot better, is all.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Other than that, though, although I don't see how Jaime Lannister survived fighting all those things with one arm, one good sword hand, but plot armor again, you know?
You know, it's crazy how much that plot armor will save you.
It's amazing, right? When you need to die somewhere else. Okay. But other than that, I didn't have a problem with that fight. The whole team of, there's millions of people, and where they get these, I have battle at Winterfell. I'm like, that's the whole purpose of the castle. Were you not listening, Kiddies? About this forever since we started talking about the White Walkers in the past and blah, blah, blah. You know, it's literally called Winterfell. Right? Where do you think the battle's going to happen? Why do you think John had to take back Winterfell? Okay, you know, from the Boltons, and why it was so freaking important to not just get rid of the Boltons because they're horrible, but he needed to battle the White Walkers from Winterfell.
If the war happens when winter comes, I would assume that it will happen where winter falls.
Yes, and I understand winter will fall everywhere, but come on. They gave you...
Right. There's...
They gave you in the first season, because George R. Martin writes this way, he gives you the name and the place of where something will happen. And anybody who reads his stories knows he's dropping these little Easter eggs like all over the place. And he literally named that castle for where the battle would take place. sense, right? And then like, and the White Walkers would be defeated.
It's kind of like,
so the people who are angry that they didn't are like just stupid.
It's kind of like Darth Vader, Vader meaning father in German.
Yeah.
And that being right. Like the biggest cinematic plot twist, like,
right.
Literally exactly. Said it in his name.
I know. It is kind of awesome. And I get it, you know, but I don't know why anybody would thought that this battle would be like in, you know, not so wintry King's Landing. Why would they go down south to fight this battle when, right. Hello? I don't know. That was just a big pet peeve of mine that people bitched about that happening there. And they're like, that should have been the end of the show. No, it should have been, because the show is called Game of Thrones. It can't be the end. That's just one threat to humanity. We still have another threat to humanity. Right.
Plus, a human threat. You don't think, like, after you save the world, that the world isn't going to fight amongst itself?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You know, and that was the thing that I liked about the story. You know, they couldn't even truly come together for a threat like that, that people couldn't truly come together. You had people that, like, deserted John, you know, and took their people back to wherever, you know, wherever they came from, to their houses. They wouldn't even come together for that reason. You couldn't even get somebody like Cersei to come together for that reason. That's how much power and greed corrupts people. So, but I don't know. Other than that, I was thought that the last season was pretty good. And then the last thing I'll say is people complained about Daenerys when she was going to, they were making a little detour. They were going to go to King's Landing, but I think they were going like via through like Dragonstone or White Harbor or someplace like that. And when her other dragon got shot down. So when Rhaegal got shot down. And I think people really bitched about that mostly because the writer said something really stupid. The showrunner said something really stupid in an interview that just kind of put the nail in that coffin. And they actually... They literally said in an interview that she kind of forgot about what's-his-face's army. I'm like, why would you say that in an interview? Because, first of all...
The hell do you forget? How do you forget?
That's what they said in the interview, and people took that and ran. And I was like, when they were in the room up at Winterfell, before they went down south to go after Cersei, they were literally laying out their plan, right, of attack. Right, Tyrion and them, and they talked about how that they were specifically going that way to avoid any possible ships. Okay, from, oh my god, what was his name? Theon's uncle. He was so awful. Euron. I hated his character so much. They specifically talked about that in their battle plan. So when the writer said she kind of forgot about them, that's where fans like lost their collective shit. Like, no, who the fuck forgets about that? And I don't know that it was really meant that way, but, and they just said that. And I think from what they said in the previous scene, they were totally going that way.
How dumb can you be to be that loose with your words, knowing the entire world is watching with the amount of weight that they have? You know what I mean?
I don't know. I almost feel like they were just like, by the time it was all done, like, we're so over this. You know, I don't know, but it was a really dumb thing for them to say. And just as dumb was what they said in regards to the end, like towards the end when Drogon burned the throne. Why didn't you just let people believe that Drogon had an inner sense or an inner wisdom that he should burn the throne, because that is ultimately what killed his mother? So instead, the showrunners come out with this bullshit like, oh, it was the script leaked or something, and they came out with this bullshit. You know, he was just in a rage. You know, that his mother was dead, and that was just a big ugly thing in the room that he focused his rage on because he wouldn't kill John. I'm just like, you could have covered your asses so much better.
With you know? A little bit of emotional intelligence.
Right. Honestly, I could have saved them. All we had to do was say, Daenerys always said, a dragon is not a slave. Which what she did to Drogon was taking Drogon and making Drogon do things Drogon wouldn't have probably done on his own, right? All they had to do is say that the dragons had wisdom, right? because they were supposed to be these wise and like amazing creatures. And instead the showrunners come out and be like, oh, it was just this big stupid thing in the room and he was just mad. No, you should have let people believe that he knew what he was doing. He did it on purpose. Jesus. Right? Yeah. So I think with the way things kind of went down in the show, the way that the showrunners just kind of kept putting their feet in their mouths did not help anything with that last season. Not at all. Not at all.
Yeah. I mean, I will always appreciate them for what they did in bringing us the series.
Me too.
I did lose a lot of respect for them just with some of the corners that were cut.
I don't know.
I understand that in many ways it probably wasn't intentional on their part.
I don't think it probably was. I mean, this was like, I think probably the biggest production.
But all the more of a note to their unfitness, you know?
Well, yeah, you know, and I'm not talking to everybody, just the showrunners. I'm just not sure, like, maybe they shouldn't have done any interviews. I don't know. Because their interviews just made things worse.
Knowing the impact on the global community, I wouldn't have taken any.
No, you know, not for a while. Let things calm down, right? Let things calm down and then maybe do those interviews, because some of the things they said just kind of, it just, you know, those of us who are super fans and we try to justify some of the things that we were seeing, then they would come out and say something that would make it completely unjustifiable. We're like, well, you know what? Fuck you. We tried to help you guys. You like ruined it.
It's like they don't say anything soon enough, and then by the time they do say something, they undo all the healing that happened in the time that they weren't saying anything.
No, but I will say, no matter what happened in that last season, I will always be a fan of Game of Thrones. It'll always be my favorite, more than likely. I do like other shows, but I don't have that passion for them that I have for Game of Thrones. I will rewatch it whenever I get a chance, and I will rewatch my favorite scenes whenever I can, and I'll appreciate the cultural phenomenon that it became, regardless of the last season, whatever anybody says. There still hasn't been anything like it, and I don't know if there ever will be.
No. And no matter what happens, the North will remember.
The North remembers, except they don't. They forgot about those White Walkers.
Those pesky things we've been bitching about for thousands of years.
Yeah. You know, the Starks have only been saying winter is coming for how long? Okay, what do you think they're talking about?
Right.
Be prepared. Be aware. You know, be ready. Winter is coming.
I think it's one of those things that, like, the longer the warning goes without
any action.
Yeah.
The less meaning it is behind us.
Yeah.
But if you think back into season one, I love that they showed this. Ned Stark, when he talked about that with Benjen, winter is coming. The way he looked, he just felt like something was coming. Something bad was coming. Which something bad was coming.
Oh,
he was
right.
Going to die. That was going to set the catalyst for the Starks to be murdered. You know, the White Walkers were coming. He wasn't wrong. You know, winter came badly. You know, so, but yeah. I encourage everybody, if you've never seen it, watch it. Don't go by what they're saying about that last season. Just watch it, because, man, it's some amazing television.
Right. And no matter who you are, what your background is, you will have a character that you connect with.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely. Definitely. And there's so many characters to feel for, you know, that you feel a passion about these characters. So I encourage everybody to watch it and give it a chance, and don't go by, you know, the disappointment in fans. I don't think that they could have probably done anything that wouldn't have caused some disappointment, because Game of Thrones itself was too big.
That's a thing. So,
you have too big of a swath of a global community that's like so passionate about this show. If they would went a completely different direction, right, and made Dany not crazy and made her and Jon fall in love and have some incestuous babies, then you would have millions of people bitching about that. The show can't have a happy ending. It can't have these people together. You know, that's not what Game of Thrones is. Blah, 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 blah. There would have always been some hatred. There would be a backlash no matter which way you would go with that, the show.
The term selling out is popular in the music industry when
yes, it is.
Bands become more interested in pandering to the fan base than mm-hmm. creating what they view as art themselves.
Right.
I think that that's what could have happened
mm-hmm.
if they wouldn't have done it the way they did.
Oh, absolutely. They would have sort of sell out. Him and Danny ended up like ruling together, and they
just because kids. Like when you have too many cooks in the kitchen, like when you're right. literally trying to get like what the world would find to be permissible,
right? And everybody would say they weren't expecting a happy ending with Game of Thrones, but they were expecting something better than that. And I think for the most part, a lot of people couldn't deal with how quickly they turned, you know, they perceived anyway how quickly they turned Danny. And I don't think that, as of somebody who's watched the show for 10 years plus and read the books, it wasn't a quick turn. It was what happens when someone snaps, right? You know, people love that show on what, ID Discovery or something, people snapped. It's literally called Snapped, where somebody just goes crazy and just murders a bunch of folks, right? So it happens to people in real life, okay? You don't want to think it's somebody you love or care about. Like this character was somebody that people loved. They named their children. You know how many people named their children Daenerys?
I know.
Because of the show?
No, I know somebody that named their kid Khaleesi. Yeah.
Yeah. So on the one hand, it does happen in real life. People snap and they kill people. And she did. You know, and it wasn't just because she was crazy, a Targaryen. It could happen to, you know, we see it happen all the time with these mass shootings. Where people just snap and go crazy and kill a bunch of folks with no criminal background.
Not to mention, like, what you were saying earlier, like, it's not like you didn't see this behavior. You just saw this behavior in a more justifiable form.
Right.
You know?
Which, you know, had Tyrion's character lay that out. You know, the people that she killed weren't, like, angels or anything. You know, did she have to crucify the slavers? No. You know, you could take their power away without crucifying them and leaving their bodies up there hanging forever. You know, did she have to burn people alive? No, but that was her thing. You know, so that's what I'm saying. Her brutality was there, but people just was like, well, they were bad people. You know, they weren't the greatest people anyway, but I always thought she kind of had that, like I said, she kind of had that satisfaction about it when she burnt people to a crisp, you know. And even the actress was shocked about her character, but I'm like, girl,
there's another
playing that.
There's another quote that says something about you know, like the longer you chase monsters, the more likely you are to become that which you're hunting.
Right.
I think that she's a perfect example of that.
Yes. Her quest for power, you know, corrupted her, and it had been corrupting her. You know, this is what you get when, you know, unfortunately, she could have been amazing. You know, she could have been, you know, her character could have been this hero, right? And she just became this power-hungry tyrant, which, you know, in the very first season when she hatches the dragons, you know, she tells people, when she wants them to follow her, you know, that their enemies would die screaming because she knew the dragons. Her plan was to get the dragons grown and burn people from that day on. You know, she told people what was going to happen if they were her enemies, you know. And I love Daenerys' character just because she was complex, brutal, and loving all at the same time. And I think other people didn't see the brutality. They only saw the good parts of her and ran with it. And they didn't see that she also had a very, very psychotic side. So, like, she enjoyed burning people up.
Yeah.
Yeah, she liked it, you know? So, and I think they just kind of ignored that because, you know, she's cute. You know, she has to see awesome dragons. Dragons are awesome, you know? I love the dragons, too. But, you know, she burned people alive. End of story. But I think that's probably the biggest disappointment with the season. People are like, what did you do to Daenerys? What the fuck did y'all do to Daenerys, right?
Well, whether you really enjoyed the show Game of Thrones or you stumbled upon this video because you left autoplay on too long, thank you for watching. If you enjoyed the content that you just watched, make sure to give this video a like. And if you want to be informed of more entertainment that is covering your favorite entertainment, make sure to subscribe to our channel for more specials just like this one. Don't forget, you can also get additional Game of Thrones content, test your trivia knowledge, and more behind-the-scenes information by going to our website at makeiticonic.events/Game of Thrones. I'm Gabe Ryan. Until next time, keep watching and make it iconic.